Good morning, friends. Hope everyone is rested and well. This is where it feels like the holidays, like for real, because we're going into Thanksgiving now. And like,
yeah.
this is where it really feels like, okay, it's going to be like a holiday month. We have a good show today, I think. Bobby Kelly and Colin and Nick DiPaolo all going to be on today.
Yeah, I mean, that's when I heard that lineup, I believe I just responded with, that's fire.
Yeah. That's a really good, it's a good show. So, you know, do you have any plans for Thanksgiving? You going to see your parents definitely, or you don't know?
Yeah, I mean, I think so. You know, everybody's starting to get, I mean, it's just so weird with the timing. Everybody's starting to get a little bit freaked out, you know, with all de Blas shutting down schools and Cuomo's losing his mind. Cuomo was getting angry at his press conference talking about de Blas in a way where it's like, what are you really angry about, dude? You know, it seemed like they're like he's upset. I think he's mad that Corona's coming back because he seemed angry. And then, yeah, everybody's just sort of, and you don't know how much of it is worrying about, you know, the impending nature of what's to come next and how much of it is really what's happening right now. I don't mean like, you know, in the way it's being reported. I mean like in your day-to-day life when you talk to people that are like, oh, I want to take my kid out of school or, you know, oh, I don't want to do this. I don't want to do that. I mean, it's interesting. All the small business owners that I've talked to don't really seem worried about shutting down. And they basically just said, well, we're not going to. Like they've all kind of got that same attitude. And I think that they probably won't have to. I don't think you can't.
Stores aren't going to shut down again.
I don't think so.
And plus people are a little better prepared this time. It does suck though. Cause you get out of it. You're like, all right, now we're kind of going back to restaurants or we're doing some things. And then some of the country is not doing it. Like Florida's doing nothing. Like in order to get into a store in Florida, you have to cough on somebody. That's like the rules in Florida. You have to cough on a person in order to be admitted.
Technically Florida's policy is, well, we never actually started doing anything. So we're just going to keep doing what we're doing.
Yeah. And I think closing the school. I was looking up the stats yesterday. New York City, like Manhattan is like a very low infection rate. It's not Manhattan. I think it's more like a couple of the outer boroughs. But if I was reading it right, it was like 0.08 in Manhattan. The city itself is okay.
I think that's what Cuomo is kind of annoyed about, that de Blas is shutting down all the public schools, even though it's really just a few neighborhoods where it's getting bad again.
Is it like in Brooklyn, a couple places in Brooklyn?
Brooklyn, Staten Island, Queens.
Oh, Queens too, yeah. Why is he shutting them all down? Why not just some of them?
Because that was the rule. Hey, we said we're going to shut down at 3%. Can't go back our word.
He's being stubborn. He wants to prove that, like, he's not Dwight Schrute, that he's his own Michael Scott.
I think it's two things. It's, number one, the teachers and the principal union are very powerful, and they agreed to this 3% thing as part of the reason why they reopened the schools.
Okay.
And, yeah, he's being stubborn.
Yeah. He wants to prove he's the boss.
Because it doesn't make any sense, to me at least, to shut down a system that has tested at 0.19% positive.
Yeah. Yeah. He's really a dislikable guy. I tried to like him. I watched something he did yesterday. He was speaking about some, and I'm trying to like him, and I just can't. I can't get there.
De Blasio?
I can't do it. Yeah. And
I watched him 6 hours late to his press conference.
Was he 6 hours late?
Yeah. He holds a daily press conference at like 10:30. And I think it wasn't until like 3 or 4 that he decided to go over there.
Oh, okay. Was he at the gym?
Yeah, he's just hanging out.
Yeah.
How embarrassing for Gavin Newsom. What a douche. Gavin Newsom is such a douche. California has had these terrible lockdowns the whole time. They've been very strict, and they're still going through the roof. It doesn't matter. And then he goes after Thanksgiving advising people and don't do that. And then he shows up at this dinner party. No one's wearing a mask. And I'm so happy someone took a photo. And it was indoors. It's outside, but it was not outside. It was outside. If you consider outside to have a roof and four walls, it was outside. What a dick. What a fucking dick that guy is.
I mean, why lie? You know that there's 11 other people there that could rat you out. Don't lie. Don't just make it up. You're going to look so stupid after. Because it's not like he forgot. Oh, it was inside. I misremembered. I thought it was outside. Like, that's never happened ever to anyone.
Did you see the photos?
I didn't. I read the story.
Yeah, they're all crowded. There's not many. There's just a couple of them, but they're all crowded around a table. It couldn't be more of a dinner party. It's like a painting. It's dinner party.
It appears to be a super spreader event.
Yeah, it's funny. I mean, that's exactly what it looks like. Yeah, there's a bunch of them around the table.
You know you're in trouble when the New York Times is bringing out their clever headlines. Like, that's usually a moment for the Post.
Right.
The New York Times says, for Newsom, the coronavirus message is, do as I say, not as I dine.
Yeah.
Not as good as the Post.
No.
No. I don't think they have the headline reporters that you know.
They're
the
like,
Post,
eh?
The Post really prioritizes that. Yeah.
Eh?
Dine. Dine.
It's a smart joke. A smart audience will get it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. They are really, really packed in there. They are really close together.
What a dick. What a fucking dick. He won't let Disney open. They hate him. Everybody hates him. He's a real dick.
Yeah, and you can tell it's inside because they're chandeliers. You could not hang them from the sky. They would have to be hung from a roof.
Yeah, those are not outdoor. They're not outdoor lights. Chandeliers are typically indoors.
There's a big mirror on a wall, which would lead me to believe that it would be inside because if it were outside, it would look weathered. Who has a mirror? To. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's almost like the room looks like it's pretty big, except they've gone out of their way to not use all the space in the room.
Yeah.
They've decided to peg in this. As I'm looking at this photo, I would classify this as a super spreader event. Yes.
Yeah.
Well, you could have argued that they were outside because the sliding glass door to the room was open, but they had to close it because they were being so loud.
Because they were being loud.
Yes. Which is something else that he has asked his citizens not to do. No singing, no yelling at Thanksgiving.
They were being so loud that you could hear them out the open door and it was disruptive to the neighbors?
Yeah, that's right.
That's so loud.
With corona. They had to close them in with their disease to leave you guys sick.
This is why nothing's ever going to change. Like, this is why...
No, because...
Even if there's national mandates, you've still got leaders doing exactly the opposite of what they're asking you to do. So how is anybody supposed to take anything seriously?
Yeah. Who listens to them?
Yeah. Why?
Who listens to them? Yeah. Because they were tested. Yeah, were they all tested first? Maybe they were, but it's still.
Doesn't matter. He's doing exactly what he wants people not to do on Thanksgiving.
Exactly what he told people not to do. Yeah. What a dick.
Nobody said, hey, everybody get tested before Thanksgiving and then you're all good. They're saying don't have Thanksgiving.
Yeah.
Except he's like, you know, I can still have a dinner party on just a random Friday. I can have my Friendsgiving. Gavin Newsom wouldn't give up his Friendsgiving. But everybody else in California is supposed to give up their Thanksgiving.
For me, I dislike him for a lot of reasons. So this is like the final reason that I dislike him. Like, this is just one of those things. It's like, this is reason number 10 that I'm like, just an ass. Yeah, I was trying to think of a high number. Here's why I didn't. I'll tell you, my mind just did. This is reason number, and then I realized, what if he says to me, name a few of the reasons? I can't. So I decided to keep it a lowball number. Or just ask, like, what don't you like about it? And I realized I don't have a whole lot on the tip of my tongue other than it's taxing. So I realize I probably have one or two that I can name other than I just don't like him. So keep the number low and manageable.
No, he's shitty.
He is shitty.
No one's going to fight you.
No, but somebody might just ask.
I thought we were going into a bit. The top 10 reasons Jim Norton doesn't like Gavin Newsom. Number 10.
Yeah, I couldn't have come up with more than two. He's taxing the shit out of people. Three, the way he handles the homeless. I don't like that. Although people blame the mayor of L.A. I just don't like him. And again, he's reminded me of de Blasio. Yeah, and the fact that he's doing shit like that. Like, you're telling people they don't see their families, but you're sitting there with your loud fucking friends. What a dick.
That's so loud. I didn't realize that the problem was that it was too loud, so he had to shut the door.
And that's just a technicality. Well, it's outside just because the sliding door is open.
They probably said it was outside because they didn't know that anybody took photos of them.
Of course.
Yeah, whoops. Whoops. Yep. Yeah, the sliding door being open, by the way, does not count as being outside.
No.
That's like having a window open. That's not, that doesn't count at all.
No, what do you think? The corona just goes around your friend's nose and out the thing? It's the same as sitting inside.
I thought it was like having a dog that, like, if you open the door, it just runs outside real quick.
Yeah, you don't have to worry. You don't have to worry.
Corona.
Sliding doors open. Fans on. It's blowing that way. Oh, okay, good. Like smoke.
That's my plan for Thanksgiving. I've got a new corona protection device. It's a doorstop. So we're just going to open the door at Thanksgiving and just let the corona go out the door. And we'll have, like, you know, 50 people over. But the
door
will
be open. That's the best way to do it. To make sure the door is open. Yeah, yeah. You're fine.
Yeah, so should be fine. We'll even open a window if need be.
Yeah. But that's an embarrassing photo. That's a really embarrassing photo.
That's bad. My favorite photo yesterday was Aunt Becky's husband heading off to jail. It's so great. Because you look at these photos. And this guy was, like, gorgeous walking into court. I mean, he was downright pretty walking into court. He was clean shaven. He had, you know, a $1,000 haircut. He had his expensive suit on and everything. I mean, you know, the whole thing. Like, he looked like money, and he looked pretty. And then there's a paparazzi snapped one photo of him. And, you know, you get whatever. He had 2 months between his trial and going to jail or however long it was. So he shaved his head bald and grew a big beard. So that way he walked into jail like a badass.
Is that what he's doing? That's embarrassing. Yeah. What do you think you're going to kick everybody's ass?
He wants to go in looking. I'll bet you he was sitting at home watching jail movies and then watching, you know, Lock Up and Love After Lock Up and all jail shows, Scared Straight 2000. And he was like, I know what I need to do. I can't be walking into jail like this. I look like money. I look soft. Yeah. So he definitely, because you look at his hair. I'm looking at his hair right now as he was walking into court. He's got a great head of hair. This isn't a guy who at some point is going to have to shave his head. Like, he's good.
It looks like it's not a wig. And you wonder, like, well, is because he's salt and pepper. And you're like, is it because it's going to be coming back in completely gray? And so does he dye half of it? And maybe that's the reason where he's like, let it go completely bald and I'll grow it slow. Or
because he grew a big white beard.
Yeah, I don't know what he's thinking.
I agree with Sam. He wants to look like a badass.
He wants to be really badass. He's also less tan. Like, he stopped hitting the tanning bed. If you look at the court photo, he looks all tan in Hollywood. And he doesn't look tan anymore in the TMZ photo of him going to jail. He's trying to not look rich in Hollywood.
Yeah. Although it's a soft jail he's going to. He's not going to fucking San Quentin. He's going to the same kind of place she went to.
You don't know. He's scared. There was a news article that said Aunt Becky was having a really bad time in jail. She's all worried and scared, too. I don't know what she thinks is going to happen to her, but I don't know, man. Maybe they've been living a very, very, very cushy life.
Sure.
You know, they're very, very rich to the point where they're kind of out of touch, possibly, which is regular life. So imagine going so far down the ladder that you're skipping regular life and you're ending up in jail. You do wacky things.
And I wonder if it's a germ thing, too. Is he a germaphobe? I know Howie Mandel eventually shaved his head because it was the germs. And you're like, is this guy going into jail? is the idea of all these fucking bugs and this dirt have him freaked out as well.
What's more germy than a big beard around your mouth? All I do is I sit there tasting food, and I'm like, oh, I don't think I ate that today. I think that was yesterday. You know, I mean, there's if no germaphobe decides to grow a big mustache and beard around their mouth before they go to jail. Yeah, you know, if you were like clean, like Mr. Clean, then I would say that might be a theory I could get behind. But that big beard is what made me realize because the article that I saw, the headline just said he shaved his head. So it's like, okay, well, I want to see, because I thought the same thing as you. I was like, okay, this guy probably knows he's not going to get his $1,000 haircuts while he's in jail. So he figures he'll just shave it and then let it grow back or whatever. But then when I saw the beard and I saw him less tan, I was like, this guy thinks he's going to a jail movie. This guy wants to walk in and, like, he's not going to hit the first guy he sees, but he at least doesn't want to look like fresh meat.
He doesn't want to look like a victim, yeah.
Right. However, I think people are going to know who he is when he walks in. And you, like you said, it's a soft jail anyway. It's not a hard jail.
Yeah.
But if there is anybody to worry about, they're going to know that he's just trying to look like he belongs in jail. They're going to know it's a big phony disguise.
Hello, fellow inmates.
You're not going to have a lot of fights there. This is the type of place that they send guys for financial crimes. There's not even I guess there is a fence around it, but it's a minimum security. Nobody in these places usually. I think Jared got beat up, but maybe because of what he had done. Yeah, I guess, you know, because it was underage shit. Maybe that's why he got in trouble.
Yeah, he's a little different.
Yeah, this guy's financial shit. No one cares.
No, this guy's going to be able to go into jail, and any problem that he has, he's just going to be able to give people financial advice.
Yeah.
You know, he's going to be able to do everybody's taxes. What's Jared going to be able to do? Jared's going to be able to tell people, give people sandwich recommendations, and then also tell stories about going over state borders to pick up underage girls. Like, that's not a skill set for jail.
No. They're just going to be out. What are we in now? November, end of November, December, January, February, March. He'll be out in April. I mean, and probably even less than that.
For the spring.
Yeah, for the spring. It does suck he's going to spend Christmas in jail, but I think they did a smart move by pleading guilty when they did, because I think with the coronavirus that they got less than they might have gotten, or there was less interest in sending them because there's so much other shit happening. They're like, all right, let's just wrap this up, get rid of them.
But don't you think if they had just pled guilty at the beginning, they would have gotten less? Like
in the very beginning, yeah. In the very beginning, right. But once they had pled not guilty, although who knows? You never know. Like, do they want to make an example out of them? There was a few of them that kind of hung on to not guilty, and you're like, what the fuck are they doing? Like, you're not going to get a whole lot of jail.
Yeah, but what's her name? Only did 2 weeks.
11 days.
Felicity Huffman did, 11 days.
But she spent 15
It would have been
grand.
So funny, dude. Imagine if he shaved his head and grew a beard to do 11 days in jail.
Yeah, I think.
I think it is funny to see, though, how nervous. Like, he is terrified. The only reason you shave your head to grow that big beard is because he's spent, and it takes time to grow a beard that looks like that. Yeah. It's a pretty good beard. Like, he's been terrified for the last several months.
Yeah. I mean, it's scary, I'm sure. Even if it's a minimum security, it's still jail. I'm sure that you still don't want to be fucked. There's probably still that impression that somebody's going to try to hold you down and stick their dick in you. It's probably still a fear. You want to be less attractive. You want to be less attractive. But yeah, what's her name? Felicity Huffman, I think, spent... Wasn't it 15 grand or something? It was like a really low amount. So,
yeah, it was much less, yeah.
Yeah, and it was just her. I mean, these two had a whole fucking thing going for $500,000.
Yeah. But she also, Felicity also, like, apologized and wrote a letter, like, you know.
Immediately.
Yeah, Lori and Walter White over here were very, you know, we didn't do anything wrong.
He really is trying to look like Walter White. He wants people to think he's broken bad, and he has not.
No, he has
not. So it's a fib. Like, he wants people to think the reason he's going to jail is because he's some kind of master criminal. But that's not true.
I must have looked like a Nelly.
He really looks like he's gotten his jail education from the television.
Yeah, that's probably the thinking. Yeah, but he just wants to look not sexy. He doesn't want to look kissable. He doesn't want to look sexy. He doesn't want his mouth to look appetizing.
Mission failed.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of people like that rugged look. Yeah, but he looked pretty as hell before. Like, he was like, he looked real, real sexy, you know? Looked like a sexy old man. Yeah. Like, this is what George Hamilton thinks he looks like.
How old is George Hamilton?
I mean, he's way older than Massimo.
He's got to be pushing 80, right?
Yeah, I would think so. Yeah, he looks great for 80, George Hamilton. I'm not trying to throw any shade at George Hamilton, but, you know, that's Troy Kwan's role model, George Hamilton.
Yeah, I don't blame Troy. That's a good one to have. Guy's tan, he's banging girls. He's a fucking trooper. Did he used to fuck Lyndon Johnson's daughter? How do you not look? You know how hard it is to fuck the president's daughter?
Yes, he did. And he's you know what? All these years later, he's just smiling about it. He's just happy about it.
Yeah, he is. He enjoys life. I think he enjoys being George Hamilton. I'm going to look up how old.
How could you not?
We're going to replay that interview next week, by the way.
We are.
Oh, don't get people upset.
Oh, that's right.
God damn, he looks good for 81.
Who, George Hamilton?
Always smiling, dude. Like, when you Google him, there's, like, I guess, seven pictures come up. Three, four, five. Five of the seven pictures he's smiling in. He's just happy.
You got those nice white veneers. Got to show them off.
I guess that's why.
You think they're veneers?
No.
I don't know about that.
You don't think he's just a good brusher?
Yeah.
I think he might just floss.
Your teeth at 80 don't look that good.
No.
Oh. He is Hollywood, He's Hollywood. Like, if you said, what is Hollywood supposed to be like? He would go, this is what you do in Hollywood. You get your fucking teeth veneered. You get a tan. You keep your hair nice. You're always in a suit and you fuck everything. That's what George Hamilton, that's Hollywood.
Yeah, I mean, he basically, you look at a picture of, like, young George Hamilton and old George Hamilton, and it looks like he had somebody make a mask of young George Hamilton and affix it to his face.
Whatever work he's had done, he looks good. Like, I'm looking at one picture with, like, he has no, like, makeup and he's not ready for a photo. He's in his car. He looks like Roger Stone. But aside from that, when he's like ready for the cameras, whatever work he's had done looks pretty fucking good.
Yeah, it doesn't look freakish.
It doesn't.
No, not at
all. Well, it doesn't look natural, but it does look good.
But it doesn't look like Kenny Rogers.
For 81, it looks great.
It looks like intentional. Kenny Rogers looks like something went wrong. And, like, George Hamilton looks like, that's exactly what he intended to look like. And you respect him for it. You know what I mean?
But if you didn't know he was 81, like, I don't even know if I would. Because he's always had the thing where the joke about George Hamilton was that he's tan. He's super tan. Like, that's always kind of been the thing with him, is that he's just really, really tan. So I'm going to hope for his sake that he uses spray tan and not just tanning beds, which are fucking terrible for you. But you don't see, like, what usually with this much work, it looks cartoonish after a while, but he doesn't. He doesn't look like a fucking cartoon. He looks like he's got good skin.
I wouldn't go that far. But even if he does use a tanning bed at this point, I mean, he's made it to 80 using tanning beds. Who cares, right?
You're fine until you're not. Like, you know, that's what scares you.
That's true.
Like, cancer, it's like, of course you're good. And then all of a sudden, one day, you're just not, and it's stage four. Like, that's the scary part of that shit.
And it's over.
Stay out of the sun. Yeah.
He just hangs out by his pool in Malibu.
He might.
Yeah, he does.
I don't know. Just looking at pictures of
him and Elizabeth Taylor.
Was he with her?
Hell yeah, he was. Hell yeah, he was.
Yeah, he's a handsome guy when he was young.
That's another thing that you know you're the man. If, like, you Google image George Hamilton, and it's just a bunch of pictures of him and chicks.
Yeah.
You know? Like, he's always got a lady on his arm.
He was older then, too. Like, you know, he must have a lot of skin work done. Like, a lot of, I told you that chemical peel, and it burned my neck a little. I mean, I'm fine now. It was just 2 days of a little redness. But if you do that too much, if you get 50 chemical peels or whatever, your face starts to glow. You look like you're shiny, like an apple. And I think that's what happens to some of these people. They do it so much that they just have a shine all the time.
Do that, and then you get pulled back as well. Like, look at Wayne Newton. He looks like a freak.
Let's see Wayne.
No, not Wayne. Yeah, he does. Like, when you start to look like... It's one thing, you look weird in photos for sure, Like, I'm looking at Wayne Newton right now. He looks crazy in these photos. But when you meet a person like that and you see their eyes moving around, it looks like they're trapped inside a statue.
Yeah.
Like, it looks like, oh, my God, get him out, because his eyes still have life in them and they're moving around. But there's nothing on his face or head that is his real life. He's stuck inside a Wayne Newton mask.
He's been in Vegas for 60 years. I remember we interviewed him once. I think it was on K-Rock. What I remember about him is how good he smelled. Like, he came in, again, he came in like, oh, this guy's an entertainer. Like, he, again, has an old school mentality of you have to look like you're ready to walk on stage when you go out and do press. And I, you could tell he obviously had work done. And it's not as effective as George Hamilton's. I want to see how old he is, though. He's really, he's got to be close to 80.
Well, he's got that big Wayne Newton head, too, so it's a little more difficult. There's a little more to work with. Like, George Hamilton walked in with very good facial ratios. Like, Wayne Newton's got kind of a big head and a small face, so it's probably a little more difficult to get the work done, you know? Plus, he's a big guy.
Yeah.
If you look at, like, Wayne Newton and Tom Jones, you can easily tell who had work and who decided to age gracefully.
Tom Jones is the man.
Tom Jones fucking rules.
Tom Jones is the man.
Way better than Wayne Newton.
Yeah, but he has a bulge. Look at him. Tom Jones doesn't care because he has a bulge. And he's also... that was his whole thing.
Yeah. No, I know.
Tom Jones is bulge. I mean, who cares what your head... He could literally have a fucking potted plant on his head and nobody would notice. It's a stupid bulge.
He doesn't have to overcompensate. Yeah,
exactly.
It's like... Three rows down on Google Image, it's a picture of young Tom Jones wearing super tight jeans. And, like, you know, the cutoff is just where the bulge is. And you're like, oh, okay. Yeah, I know. I know what the thing is there. But there is something. I mean, there, generally speaking, at the end of life, like, there's usually an awkward middle section. But at the end of life, the people who allowed themselves to just get old, you kind of look at with a little more respect than the... You start talking about Wayne Newton like he's a crazy person, because you can't take it off. Like, it's not temporary. So you end up aging really weird because you panic in the moment because you start to get a little older.
Yeah. I mean, it's I don't know. I don't know what goes through their head. Like, I know people have had some work done. Like, most of my friends, I don't think, have had anything done. Like, you know, the majority. I know a couple that have had little things, teeny things here and there, like very small. But now I'm getting into that age where a lot of my friends are going to be in their 60s and older. And I'm interested to see if any of them fall for this. And if it's any better. College, like, there's certain shots you get which aren't as bad because they kind of go away. But it's once they start doing heavy surgery, that's real hard. You can't come back from that. You know, you keep building on it. You can't undo it.
Or, like, what's worse than seeing people who got hair transplants done too early? So, like, they get the transplants in, and then they keep balding, but then they don't have, so they still have this weird, like, in the front, they have their hair transplants in, but then it's still bald to the back, and you can just see, like, oh, you didn't time that properly, sir.
And Jocelyn.
Or, like, the technology just wasn't there. Like, people who got hair transplants, you know, 20 years ago, and you're looking at them now, and they look like Barbie doll heads. Like, yeah, he should have skipped it, probably.
Yeah, and it's so obvious because it's like follicle, 4 inches. Follicle, 4 inches. Yeah. But Jocelyn, one of you guys just sent me this link for Jocelyn Wildstein. And, you know, she's like this socialite who, I guess, got arrested for scratching her boyfriend. But she looks natural. The work she's had done looks good.
Okay, let me see.
She doesn't look like she's had work done.
This is.
She looks like Jim Gaffigan.
It's like the cat. This is the Catwoman of New York.
Yeah.
Yeah. See, this is what I'm talking about. This looks like somebody took a mold of Jim Gaffigan's face, and she's just wearing it,
and made somehow it beautiful.
Stuck on her head,
and made it beautiful.
I mean, I don't know.
Yeah, she's beautiful.
Look, she is 76, and she doesn't have a lot of wrinkles. So that's, you know,
and that's what
that's you're going for. Yeah. If you just inflate your head like a balloon, it'll stretch the skin out enough so that there's no wrinkles, which is good. I mean, wrinkles suck, right?
Yeah.
People get so addicted to it. It's such an addiction, too. Like, it's not just about looking a certain way. They like the idea of healing and going through the whole process and the new you. So no matter what they do, they're just always going to keep building on it and piling on it. It's just, it's fucking crazy.
And they're so afraid of getting older. Like, they think that getting all this plastic surgery will make it so that death is further away. It's just not how that works.
Yeah. I mean, I hope I don't fall into that.
I hope you do so bad.
That trap. It's,
dude. You would look
lotions.
Great.
That's as far as I'll go. It'd be lotions.
Well,
lotions and
right
and
now,
lotions. Hmm? Lotions can only go so far.
Yeah, you build up that tolerance, and then you got to take another step.
No, I don't think I'll ever get.
It wouldn't be the worst thing in the world to get rid of the crow's feet, right?
No,
no, that don't bother me.
Get your nose thinned out a little bit.
My nose is great. It's the best part of my face. I have a nice tiny nose. Are you kidding me? I have a fine.
You get a chin implant. Like
Michael Jackson, get that real thin.
Michael looked good at the end.
You can't breathe it.
That doesn't matter.
Very good. Yeah, but you see, the point is that do you look good? We're at a point of fashion over function, you know?
Wow, yeah, she looks really big. It's the wrinkles. It's the cartoonish wrinkles that she wants to get rid of. What a terrible job.
Wouldn't it be great if, like, Voss made one chin joke too many and Jim just came in one day after a vacation with a giant chin implant, and we all had to act like we didn't know, like, oh, no, I didn't notice anything different.
Yeah, or I could sense that somebody was going to say something. So, Jim, and I went like, I shook my head, and I did the wave off. I don't, guys.
Don't bring it up. Don't bring it up.
Yeah. Looks like Leno all of a sudden.
Yeah.
Yeah. Not for the air. Not for the air.
Yeah.
And then, like, you know, 3 months after that, we notice his cheekbones have come up way higher than they used to be. Not for the air. Not for the air.
Yeah. That's the problem when comedians start thinking they're sexy. That's when comics go wrong, when they start to think, like, you know, we all want to look decent. But when comedians start getting that thing where they think, like, I want to be a sexy person. And it's like, if you are naturally fine, but if you're trying to make yourself sexy, it's just not, it's not going to happen.
Yeah, when comedians get plastic surgery, too, it becomes, like, one of the number one things about them. It's all people notice. Like, that's... I mean, how long, when you're talking about Carrot Top, how long does it take before somebody brings up work he's had done? Or even, like, you know, Dane. People talk about, when people talk about Dane Cook, everybody's got questions about his head.
I think more about his nude photos on Instagram.
Dane Cook?
Yeah, I think he was doing semi-nudes. He had good cheeks, too. I believe he was.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Look those up. I'll take a look at those.
Yeah. I believe.
Yeah, I didn't.
That's a while ago. I don't know if he still is or not.
Yeah, man. I mean, why not, Jim? Why do you need to age gracefully? You know, there's no reason. You have a youthful spirit. Why not have that youthful spirit be on the outside, too?
Well, you know, I don't know if I will age gracefully. I just don't want to embarrass myself with bad work that you can't undo. Like, if I knew you could undo it, or I knew it would be good, I would probably do it, but I don't know. There's no guarantee it's going to be good. And plus, again, like I said, none of my friends are doing it. So, you know, who cares?
Just roll the dice.
Roll the dice. Trey's right, actually.
With your
roll
face.
The dice.
Roll the dice with your face into a corner.
Well, I mean, Troy, you got all those tattoos, right?
Yeah.
You don't know for a fact that they're going to be good before you get them done. You just roll the dice, right?
Sure. Sure.
And then they're good.
You know?
Yeah.
And I have some that don't look good. Some look good. You know? It's like, whatever.
I mean, look, you got a DeLorean logo on the back of your neck, you know?
Yeah, I do.
You know, it's wild. It's a wild time. But you roll the dice with it. You go, how is this going to affect my life for the next, you know, 40, 50, 60 years? Let's see. Let's find out.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, and I'm not opposed to some sort of surgery. I don't want to look like a freak, but, you know.
Well, let's see. Are you known for being addictive or taking anything just like a little bit at a time? Yeah, no, I think you'd be fine with plastic surgery. I think a couple surgeries and you'll probably be out, you know?
I'll tell you what, liposuction keeps looking more attractive every day. I'll tell you that much.
You should
more than the freezing?
Freezing doesn't get it as much as you'd like it to. Freezing is like if you have a little part that's bothering you.
Right.
But, you know, just as you get older, just things just start like widening.
I know.
You know?
Freezing is like airbrushing. Freezing is like a little airbrush in the corner. But it's not going to get what you need.
Yeah, you just need it sucked out.
You're right. It's definitely a a good idea.
You know how I know Troy's thinking about lipo?
How?
Because I saw him on Instagram yesterday packing up on his mac and cheeses at the store.
Well, ever think that as you get older, you start to widen, and I don't think it helps that you go and get Cheetos mac and cheese.
Boxes.
You
know?
Well, there's three different flavors. I've never tried them. Oh. And I have seen them before, so I was at a Walmart, and I saw them. I was like, well, you know what? I'm going to try these out.
You're in Florida.
Troy, you're in Florida in a Walmart buying mac and cheese.
He's living his best life.
Bro, the best.
I feel great. I'll be honest with you.
You should. You should. And get the liposuction.
Yeah, you'll feel better.
You know, you deserve some mac and cheese. You shouldn't have to stress about it, and you wouldn't have to if you knew I got a lipo appointment coming up.
Lipo 360. That's what I'm looking into.
It's all laparoscopic, right? Like little things that just go, a couple little marks is all you wind up having on you.
Yeah, it's not bad at all.
Perfect. Can't it be just lumpy, though, if they miss you? Like, if they miss a spot, isn't it fucking like cottage cheese or lumps if they don't get evenly?
I should go get a consultation. I'll let you guys know.
Yeah.
You should. And I'm sure they'd get it evenly.
Lipo is scary because that's like getting beaten up. Like the next day or for a while, you're in bed with a fucking thing wrapped tightly around you. It's like you have the shit kicked out of you. That seems like it's a painful recovery.
It feels like everybody down here does it.
Yeah, I'm sure. Yeah.
And I feel like every billboard you see is for it. You know what I mean? Like the girls get the fat taken out of one area and put in their ass. It's like I got to figure out where I'm going to put the fat.
Florida, they'll be careful because surgeons. It's harder to sue down there for like fuck ups. Like I think the surgeons down there, they protect them a lot. So be really careful if you get like plastic surgery in Florida with what you can sue for if they botch it.
Dude, how great would that be? Florida. You get the fat taken out of your titties and put it in your calves.
Yeah.
You'd look awesome. That would look cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. And look, I mean, you're right. If everybody in Florida is doing it, and everybody's happy there. It's like the one thing Florida is known for is a bunch of good decision makers. So I would say that that's probably one where you want to follow your instinct on. I would do it.
I'll keep you guys posted. I'm thinking about it.
Yeah. Why not just – I mean, look, I'm fighting the fight. I'm getting fatter. But I'm like, no, just keep working out. Like, you know, just keep doing what it is you did the first time. Do you just kind of give up on that? You're like, fuck it.
No, I put on weight during quarantine. I weighed myself. I finally bought a scale because I just got so fed up with myself.
Yeah.
Because I went to a grocery store. There's a scale there that you can, you know, weigh groceries or whatever. And I got on it. I freaked out. I was like, I can't take this anymore. Oh, I'm tired of being fat. So now I'm running every day. I'm doing yoga every day. But it's just still hard to drop to get as thin as you'd like to be. You know, as where I'd feel good. But
you sat on the grocery scale like a hen.
Yeah.
Yeah. Fucking Troy. Good for you.
Yeah. Yeah, you want to be able to fit those t-shirts a little better. You want to not have to think about it, right?
That's right.
Yeah. They'll suck it all out of you.
And if DJing comes back anytime soon, I don't want to be the fat old guy up there. You know what I mean?
No, yeah. That's it. See, that's why Troy's going to get plastic surgery. He's already in a profession where he's got to avoid looking like the old guy. So in his quest to look young, that's where the George Hamilton's going to kick in, I think.
You know what it is? It's just staying thin. Like, you can look like an older guy. It's just when you have, like, the dad bod that just looks bad.
You don't want to be a mush at the pool.
Right.
Right. DJ Stretch Armstrong is, like, still super thin. He's got white hair thin. And everything, but he's thin, so he looks cool.
Yeah.
I guess.
Yeah, you can if you can have total white hair and be lean and you can still look cool.
But you know it's what? Just, go ahead, Troy.
No, go ahead.
No.
Oh, no, I'm just the dad bod is just not an attractive look on stage.
Especially because you're not a dad. Like, you don't even have that excuse. Like, you don't you don't have kids. Like, what do you it's like, who are you buying that Cheeto macaroni and cheese for? You're like, I just wanted to try it. You
know, I never tried it.
Yeah.
Once things are back to normal, though, you might do what you used to do. Like, that's what I keep holding on for. Like, this thing will be over in a couple months, and my schedule will be back a little bit, and then you just start living the way you're living. We're all in this fucking half-depression fucking in and out, not eating
well.
He
turned into Florida Troy. He's not going back to the way things were before.
But it means with DJing and with the world being the way it is, and I guess in Florida you can kind of do what you want, but there's still this mental thing. There's still this mental thing. Everybody's just kind of sitting in the house like a bunch of fat dicks, just shoveling it in our fucking dumb faces, depressed. Yes, we're all doing it. Everyone. That's why it's not doesn't feel as bad, because everyone you know is doing it. Like, I know like two people out of everyone I know who's lost weight during this. Everyone else, there's Bennington and like one other person looks great now, and the rest of us are just plumping up.
All those Bennington kids are losing weight. It's crazy looking at them. You got sexy Vito, you got sexy Chris, you got sexy Ron. It's amazing. I don't know how they're all doing it. How did Chris Stanley start a bread making show and lose weight at the same time?
He's pulling a Princess Diana. He's probably fucking over the toilet every day, fucking fingers down his throat. That's the best way to do it.
He's binging and purging.
Yeah, that's the best way to do it. Shove your fingers down your throat. It's amazing. Get it all out. Eat again.
Have you tried that, Troy?
I haven't. I can't make my. I hate throwing up. I'd rather. I'm just trying to cut back on my portions. I'm trying to run 4 miles a day. I do 30 minutes of yoga every day. So, I'm just trying not to eat late. What's that?
What a hassle. You could just get it sucked out. Like, I'm at portion control and 4 miles a day and half an hour of yoga. It's too much.
I hear you. I hear you. That shit's expensive, though, man.
It is expensive.
Got to be. I didn't go for a consultation, but I'm assuming it's probably 10,000 for a 360, lipo 360.
Geez. What's that, around your whole body?
Yeah, everything around.
Stomach, too, or just tits?
Yeah. Yeah. Stomach and the back. Like the back fat you get?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I get that back fat.
Oh, yeah, me too.
Does your girl care or no? Is she like, hey, you look fine?
Oh, yeah, but she's trying to plump me up. She doesn't care, you know.
I'm telling you, yeah, they want to fatten you up so you don't go out and cheat. That's what it is.
Exactly. And she's a chef, so I'm eating real good.
She cooks well, right?
Yeah, real well, yeah.
Yeah.
She's like, if DJing comes back, I want you to be the fat old guy.
Yeah, exactly. DJ Piggy Boy. Hold on. You know what? It's I'm reading it, Troy. It doesn't look like it's that expensive. It doesn't look crazy. It looks like it's $3,200. Now, that's probably a very low place, but 10 might be on the high side.
Mm. Yeah, go find the cheapest one.
That's actually a great idea.
Yeah, that's probably the way to do it. And we can start a GoFundMe as a show. Let's get Troy addicted to plastic surgery.
The average price is $47.50 in Miami.
Okay.
Okay.
So $5,000. That's the average. You can go up to $8,000 if you want to do, like, I guess, a really good one, but it's about that's the average.
You should come down and get it done with me, Jim.
No, I don't want it. I don't want it.
What?
Like, I don't want the recovery. Like, you know, I don't mind just getting, it's a miserable week, and I know people have had it done. And then people can wind up eating bad anyway. And then it comes back, and it comes back in pockets and like, ugh.
Yeah, but I bet it's a pretty great month or so right after.
Yeah.
I bet you feel really good right after recovery before you start getting fat again. Probably feels awesome. And then you can always get it done again.
And when you get down, you probably want to stay slim. You don't want to fatten back up.
You do, but the problem is, like, I know I'm compulsive, and I eat compulsive. We all do. So, like, I got to change what I'm doing, which makes me fatter, or else I'm going to stay fatter. I don't want to just get something sucked out, risk surgery, and then get fat again in 6 months. It's crazy.
Yeah.
Well, I'll keep you guys posted.
Yeah, please do.
Please do. I want to know.
I do, too.
I was reading that... after the debacle that was the Great Pumpkin Charlie Brown, Apple signed a deal with PBS so that PBS could air the Charlie Brown Thanksgiving and the Charlie Brown Christmas. And all I could think about was that Apple is now like the dongle connecting Charlie Brown to PBS. Like, they're just in the business of connecting. They buy up everything that you need, and then they make you pay more to use it. That's the business. That's the business model. It's good, obviously. It's working.
Yeah. Hey, look, as a stockholder, I'm not going to... As a consumer, it annoys me, but as someone with Apple shares, I'm like, you know what? Whatever you got to do.
And HBO Max is HBO Max made a big move. We've been teasing them for their name and everything, but putting Wonder Woman on their app for free on Christmas, it's going to fuck up the whole streaming game for everybody. Like
a new one?
Wonder Woman. Yeah. So the new Wonder Woman, which people have been waiting for, like, because the Wonder Woman was actually really good. It's like the one DC movie that was really, really good. And people have been waiting for it and figuring out, like, what they're going to do. So they announced that on Christmas, they're going to put Wonder Woman out in theaters, and they're going to drop it on HBO Max at the same time. But they're not going to charge extra for it. The way, like, Disney Plus put out Mulan, but they charge $30 if you want to see it. And everybody was like, well, I don't want to see it anyway. So, no. HBO Max is just going to have it. So it's $15 a month that you're paying anyway. And then, boom, Christmas Day, Wonder Woman 1984 or whatever it's called, pops in. Which, I mean, that's easily a $30 movie on any other streaming platform. So I think I think it's going to be successful. I think it's going to get HBO subscribers up, and I think it's going to potentially change things for streamers again as they figure out this business.
Yeah, everybody is just grabbing up content and running into their separate corners. And you have to have this one and then have that one. And then you're like, oh, you know what? Cable wasn't that bad. Like, except for the fact you couldn't choose when you watched it. Now you look at it and go, cable? Yeah, but I had HBO. I had Cinemax. I had Showtime. I had ESPN. You had everything that you kind of wanted. And you'd pick your packages. There was a little less mobility. But then you're like, I want to watch something. I don't even know what service it's on. Like sometimes you'll want to watch and they go, oh, no, Netflix doesn't have that anymore. That went to so-and-so. Oh, they have it, but now it's not under a different name. It's a pain in the ass.
I don't think anybody's going to miss cable. I mean, they're still paying less. Cable became crazy expensive, and you just had to wait until stuff was on. And you didn't have access to every show ever and the complete seasons of those shows.
Yeah, so the streaming, the part of it that is like Netflix, and that is great. But you also had regular TV with cable. And the pricing got fucked up, and that was kind of where they screwed themselves, and the lack of just availability whenever you wanted it. But something that centralizes it, people are going to miss, because you have to have two or three different streaming services, know which this is on the here. It's just stupid.
I mean, I think of it just like TV, like, oh, okay, what channel is Seinfeld on? What channel is, you know?
Maybe you don't need to sign up for something different for Seinfeld and log into something else for Seinfeld. You know what I mean?
You do it for HBO and Showtime and all the premium channels and pay-per-view. And do I have the right package for this? And, oh, this channel doesn't come on that package. I have to call my cable company and now pay for 17 channels because I want to see one show.
But you knew where it was. Like, you knew where it was. At least you did. With cable, you just kind of knew. Even though cable sucked, you knew where it was. With this, you don't even know sometimes which ones does Disney have, which ones does HBO Max have. What's under the heading of HBO Max? Which one does that have? You have to just go into these totally different systems and find things. Oh, no, Hulu has that one. Everything is still... Like, I wish it would be nice if you could have a couple of different subscriptions and then one app that searches all the other apps.
Apple TV does that.
You can search everything that you... apps.
If you just say, like, Wonder Woman, it'll come up and it'll show you where it is available to stream or buy.
Oh, that's great. I didn't know that.
Yeah. No, it's great.
Yeah.
Okay, so that kind of works like that. Like, is it something that centralizes all this other shit? Because if you don't know where it is, like, there's been movies I've looked for recently. I'm like, where the fuck is this? It's not on Netflix. It's not on, I'll usually buy it off iTunes. I just buy it or rent it on iTunes.
Yeah, but we're also, like, it's not like when we had cable, we could sit there and be like, oh, I'm just looking, like, you couldn't, if a movie just popped into your head and you're like, I would like to see this movie. You wouldn't go, oh, it's definitely on cable right now. You know, you would scan through the channels on cable to see what was on. Now it's like, this is a thing that exists that I just thought of that I would like to see. And you just know it's somewhere.
Yeah.
But when everything's available, like, it can't be that easy, you know, unless you just want one streaming service.
Or just one thing that searches them all. Well, if Apple TV does that, if it searches them, it will tell you exactly where it is.
Yeah.
Because I hate the idea of all of these different ones starting their own streaming services and then just taking up what their company has done and put it just kind of is irritating. But yeah, with cable you couldn't always see what you wanted. So there's a lot about it that sucked. It was overpriced. I just like the idea of something being centralized if you want it. For me, it's iTunes. I'll just buy it on iTunes or rent it for $4.
Yeah, but then your problem is a monopoly, and they're just charging as much as they want.
Yeah, exactly. They're terrible.
Yeah, totally.
They're terrible. There was just something about being centralized that I made it a little bit simpler. You knew where
it was it was also easier. Like Sam, like there wasn't the option to just stream anything and get anything at any moment. If you wanted to watch a movie, you know, you would have to see when is the next time it's playing, and then let me set my DVR.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah,
it wouldn't occur to you to be like, where is the complete series of Seinfeld? And I could watch. I just thought of a random episode.
Yeah.
I would like to watch that right now because it's, 2:30 in the afternoon on a Sunday.
Yeah.
Yeah. What was all your DVD collection? That's what it was.
Yeah, exactly.
It was take out your DVD collection. Now this just kind of cuts it out. I have to give it to that.
You'd pull out your box set and you'd realize there was one disc missing.
Oh, fuck.
Oh, no, this is the one that the episode was on.
Where did I took it out and I put it in a different case.
Yeah. And then you find it on a shelf. And you're like, great. But then the bottom's all scratched up because you didn't put it back in the case properly. And you're like, bah.
There's nothing I want to see bad enough, I don't think, to get a service outside of Netflix. Like, I can't think of anything like I really...
You only have Netflix?
I have Netflix, but I have HBO because I have Verizon Fios. So I have, like, whatever comes with that I have. So I can watch certain things when I'm away. But, yeah, I don't have HBO Max, I don't think, unless it comes with it. I don't have Disney. To my knowledge.
Well, I mean, I wouldn't have Disney if I didn't have kids, I don't think. You know, right. I haven't used it at all for myself. I don't watch Mandalorian. A lot of people do, but so I don't watch Mandalorian.
Huge.
Everybody
it's
says
huge.
It's great.
Yeah. Yep.
And Sasha Banks is on it, so.
One episode.
Well, so far.
That's true. So
does
far.
She,
that's
does she
true.
Die at the end?
No. So no, she does not.
Maybe she's on another
spoiler.
One. I don't know. Does she play Jango Fett?
Yep.
Oh, cool. That's awesome.
Yeah.
I don't think we would be getting Wonder Woman for free.
Right.
You know, if there wasn't this much competition between streaming services.
I think that, and there's going to be such a backlog of movies that, now it's running into like this situation where Disney and Warner Brothers and whoever else, like, they've got all their 2021 movies, and if you put too much out, like, and who knows how much longer you're gonna have to delay movie theaters reopening, and now you've just got this like backlog of films,
So
until you can shoot them, how long until you can start shooting again? Like, they're shooting now, but the insurance is expensive.
Shooting.
It's hard to do.
I read that they wrapped shooting on Scream. On the new screen.
I read
already.
That too.
But then it's not coming out till 2022 because they've got movies that are coming out in 2021. I think the most surprising thing is they're not charging extra for it.
That's crazy.
But then I read something else that it's only free for 30 days and then they're throwing it up on video on demand.
I mean, that's even smarter.
Yeah.
Because you get all, like, there's now an immediacy to it.
Yeah, and
sign
if they're smart, they'll cut
January.
Off free trials. Like, Disney did that before they put out Hamilton. Like, 2 weeks leading up to Hamilton's release, no more free trials. Because they knew everybody was just going to sign up for a free trial to watch Hamilton.
Yeah, I think that's
we
right.
We should break, I think, because we have Colin coming in a few minutes, and then we have Bobby, and then we have Nick. So we should, so we don't get backed up. I have Chip Chipperson's Christmas store is open. If you want to go to chipchipperson.com and get Christmas merch, it's available. There's a lot of stuff. There's cups and shirts.
What shirt are you wearing today? Okay.
It's the Grinch.
Chip. It's an all over print, obviously. Yeah. Chip on the roof.
These shirts are so good.
Oh, Chip is the Grinch.
Yeah, I'm very happy with them. I just got a bunch in the mail yesterday. So if you want to go there, it's a fine Christmas gift for a girl you want to fuck. Get her a Chip shirt.
Definitely.
Panties will come
definitely.
Off. They fly off.
And what would be better than seeing a girl in a Chip shirt? I mean, it's just attractive.
Yeah. Hiked up while you're banging her from the back.
We can, we could talk about it when we get back, briefly if we have time, but, new episode of Not Sam Wrestling is dropping on the free version of the WWE Network this morning at 10 a.m. Eastern. And the show, I've got Undertaker and Kane together on the show today.
Wow.
which is insane.
That's so awesome.
Yeah.
That's a huge one for the whole show.
It's the whole show?
It's the whole show.
I might have to watch this one. I generally don't like to watch your content, but I might watch this one.
Okay. Well, you could have phrased that way differently.
I mean, but I'm just very busy. I got a lot of things to do.
Sure, sure.
Yeah. I would imagine that after, with this episode, there are probably a lot of people that feel very similarly to you, Trent.
Dude, that's awesome. So I mean,
that's a great couple of people.
Yeah. At the same time, like, that's really, really cool.
Yeah, just sitting there talking to them about everything they did. It's awesome. Yeah. I'm really happy with it. So I'm excited for you all to see it. It's on the free version of the WWE Network this morning at 10 a.m. Eastern. Check it out. And we'll be back with Bobby Kelly and Colin Quinn.
Yes.
We are going to take a commercial break right now. Don't go anywhere. Jim and Sam will be right back after this. Jim Norton and Sam Roberts Show is returning from break.
Welcome back, everybody.
Yeah.
To those of you that stuck with us. And nice to see Colin. I knew Colin would be on time. He's a very responsible person. Welcome to the show, Colin.
Colin Quinn. Who is just, by the way, I mean, Colin is moving product during this pandemic. A book, an HBO Max special.
Yep.
This guy, he's just waiting in the cut, waiting. And then when that Colin Quinn drop comes, shakes the world. Welcome, Colin.
Thanks, guys. I like that your guys are playing Pat Benatar. That's because of my tweet yesterday.
What was the tweet?
I figured when the song came on that this must be CQ related somehow.
I think it must be Travis is following my Twitter like a stalker.
That's right.
It was Travis. What did you say about Pat Benatar in your tweet?
I just pointed out that nobody ever mentions Pat Benatar when everybody gets mentioned in the past since social media started. Nobody's mentioned her name once, and it's just weird. And you go to like an 80s show and you said like, hey, where's Pat Benatar? People would look at you like you have three heads.
Yeah. I think she's very underrated, if you want the truth.
Yeah, well, that was kind of what I was saying, but okay.
Yeah. Well, you just think nobody. You weren't saying that was a good thing. You weren't saying that she wasn't mentioned because you said nobody mentions her.
Right.
But you didn't say in the context of great music.
I didn't want to put the judgment into the universe. I just let people draw their own conclusions.
Yeah, well, I'm going to go for it. Well, I'm taking the risk. That's the difference.
The average dope like you would say, I think she's underrated.
Well, I do. I do believe she's underrated. And I've been a Benatar fan from way back, as you may not know.
And, Colin, you did say a few people that talk about her never admit that Little Too Late is one of her better songs.
Little Too Late, that's what started the whole thing off yesterday. I was thinking, it's a little too little, it's a little too late. And I was like, right. That's pretty good lyric, you know?
I think you might just be trying to start through your social media influence. I think you're starting to you're trying to start an interest in retro MTV, hoping that people will think Pat Benatar, think of the old MTV days. Oh, what else was on MTV?
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, boom, we're back, baby. We're back. Time for a reboot.
Well, it started, I think, it was just really into lyrics, because last week I realized like one of the most profound lyrics, which people don't give enough credit, is there were four men all together, yet they were all alone. And that's kind of a deep thought. But then a few of my, from the Brady Bunch, you know. And then one of my followers pointed out Alice did live with those four guys at the time. So it's inaccurate lyrics.
She did.
Huh.
I didn't know Alice was with Brady. What?
I didn't know that either. I didn't know that. That was news to me. I just thought Alice came along when the families joined, but it would make sense that Alice would have had to come from someplace.
Yeah.
The Bradys.
Now it is like old. I do feel MTV days. Yeah.
Yeah.
What do you mean?
Well, we used to talk about the Brady Bunch on remote control all the time.
Yeah, it's not really the reference anymore, unfortunately. Unless you're talking about AIDS, and it's a great one. But aside from that, it's not really, it's not like the cultural family reference. There's a bunch of other families that have come along since, unfortunately. Cosby's.
Does that bother you, Colin, that every time you go anywhere, people are like, oh, you got to do a tough crowd reunion. You got to do a tough crowd reunion. And nobody's sitting there going, when are you going to bring back Remote Control? Don't you think Remote Control could be a podcast?
No, people said that a long time ago. Hey, a podcast, that's a good idea.
A remote control.
No, I mean, I don't, you know, either one of them really is not that interesting to me.
Come on, tough crowd. Let's do it as a podcast.
But how great would it be if you put on Twitter, guys, I'm bringing back one of my old shows as a podcast, and you watch all the tough crowd people freak out, and then Remote Control the podcast comes out. I think it'd be great.
Or you just do SNL, do Weekend Update.
On the weekend.
Do your own Weekend Update. Do you in front of a green screen?
No, but I was thinking of opening up a series of chain bars, because you guys have John Tapper on all the time.
Yeah.
My bars would be called CQ's MTV SNL Comedy Central bars. And that's where I get all the promotion from those places.
That's a great idea, and you can get them to sponsor it. Yeah, CQ's, what was it now? SNL Comedy Central.
Remote Control Comedy Central.
Comedy Central bars.
I would say instead of Comedy Central, I would say Tough Crowd. I would keep it on brand. I would say.
Yeah, just call the bars Tough Crowd.
Wow. Yeah,
Tough Crowd, the bar. Tough Crowd, dot, 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 the bar. That's a great one.
Well, I think that kind of ruins it, but, you know. We'll have to talk
about that. No, I think that it adds to it. And I think the SNL could be a burger. I think you could have different burgers.
By the way, I know it's old news and we've talked about it before, but you and Sam going undercover in that bar literally looked like two of my aunts giggling and smoking to each other like, whoa, what an exciting night out. with a couple of Rob Roy's and Manhattans.
Yeah, we did look like fucking squares. I'll admit.
John Taffer thought he was teeing us up, but he didn't realize that he did us no favors with our audience when he introduced us as, here's Jim Norton and Sam Roberts, and these guys know bars. Our audience did not take kindly to
no,
that.
No, we don't. I've done enough gigs in them, but yeah, no, I don't know bars.
The problem with social media is everybody's fans are also there to abuse you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Some innocent person wanders in and goes, I think you guys are great. And even you think, shut up, idiot. You don't even
understand. Yeah, you don't know what's happening here. But that was embarrassing, being brought on as experts for the bar. And like they cut out the part where I said with no alcohol. Like I ordered something with no alcohol. And they cut it out to make it look like I was a real real drinker, like I was in there having a drink.
And when you guys, I'll have to watch it again, but I mean, you know.
Oh, it's great.
I feel like you guys were sitting at a table. You weren't even at the bar. Is that right?
No, we were at the bar.
No, we were at the bar. But you should have seen the producers running around in a tizzy. We get there and they're like, so what drinks were you guys thinking about ordering, blah, blah, blah. And Jim drops it on them right before we're about to shoot. Jim drops on them. Well, I'm sober. I don't drink at all.
Yeah.
You should have seen 100 people start moving around trying to figure out, what are we going to do here? What can this guy order? They're like, Sam, you drink, right? And I was like, yeah, all the time. Yep, nonstop. Lush over here. Huh?
Yeah, you drink, but then you have to drop the bombshell on them. I only eat like chicken wings and fried pickles.
We really were. Jim and I both knew going in that we were a very poor choice.
Yeah,
we had made the deal with each other that we weren't going to inform them of the poor decision that they had made until at the very last minute.
Yeah, it's a fun trip to Florida, doing a show we liked. Like, yeah, why not? Like John
Bar Rescue.
It was fun. Yeah. I wasn't prepared for the question of how many listeners do you guys have. I told the truth. I couldn't make it up.
They had to edit it out. This non show business person. They had to edit the question out entirely. John was trying to make a point and he walked in, and he had the bar owner by his side, and he just jumped out at us. And he's like, these are my friends, Jim Norton and Sam Roberts, one of the most popular shows on Sirius XM. How many listeners would you guys say that you have? And Jim just looks at him, and he goes, well, they don't tell us.
Yeah, I told him the truth. We don't know.
First of all, if Jim ever, what he did a minute ago, if he ever pronounces listener with the T again, I will find him and stab him to death.
Wait, did I, listener, what did I say?
Did you?
The listener.
No.
Oh,
How many listeners?
I guarantee because it sent it like a pain through my jawline.
Oh, sure it wasn't cock?
Oh, boy. were we in the bus on the way to school when we were 14?
The back of it, huh? Yeah, the little yellow one.
Colin, I really enjoyed the HBO Max show, Colin Quinn and Friends, a parking lot comedy show. And I feel like we're starting to lose, you know, there's so much inside comedy going on with all the podcasts and everything, but nobody really talks about the joy that other comics take in seeing people bomb. Like nobody, yeah. That's not nearly talked about the way it used to be. So getting to see that on HBO and actually watching people's reactions, like we had Keith Robinson on a couple of days ago, and I had to ask him, Keith Robinson, he's a
Philly guy.
Yeah. But my favorite part of the whole special was when you and Bobby got up out of your seats because you thought Keith was bombing. And then the look of utter disappointment on both of your faces when you realized, oh, no, he's doing well. No, never mind.
Yeah. Well, I mean, obviously there's a lot of schadenfreude involved. But also, I think it's also because comedians, like, we're so used to us, it's still an act. So when somebody's bombing, like, everything drops away and you're just... your shoulders drop and you're just like so real that it's just funny because you can identify with that person. Because suddenly they're like, okay, folks, what is this bullshit? You know what I mean? you can't even do, you know, our thing. You're just like, fuck it. All right. What do you want to do now, you motherfucker? You know what I mean? So I feel like there's something about it that, like any job, when you're watching somebody do it, you're putting yourself in that position. You know?
What now? Was he bombing though? Like, would you guys get? Because if you thought he was bombing, he probably was.
Keith.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, it's hard to tell because it's cars, so nobody's getting laughs. But you know, Keith came out there for God. But I mean, he had some pretty funny shit up front. I mean, he wasn't bombing because his opening line, he goes, "Where the black cars at?"
That's funny.
So. I mean, no, but, you know, you're always watching. You know how it is. Even at the cellar, when one of us walks through and you give that little look to each other when you go to the bathroom, like, uh-oh. Yeah. Even though you're doing good, you're like, this son of a bitch. You have to keep your focus, you know.
Yeah, the last thing you want is somebody walking out of the bathroom as you're getting to the punchline that just dies. You just don't want it.
I was watching some Kevin Hart thing the other day. We were talking about one time he was on stage doing his act, and Patrice walked by, Kevin just saw a phone book was flung at the stage at him, a big phone. And then Kevin's like this, and Patrice goes, "Read that. It's funnier than any of the material you've been doing." And I walked out.
I think there's a Boston Comedy Club. There was a Boston Comedy Club.
Right.
That's great.
Yeah. By the way, why did Boss get to host it?
Why would you not have Voss hosted?
Because he's not a personable individual. He's not a friendly or nice host.
First of all, he showed up. This is how oblivious Voss is to how I feel about him. He walks right up to me the first minute and goes, "Look, matches. His hat and his sneakers match. I don't give a shit."
Yeah. Or no, maybe they're both bookends around something worthless. Maybe that's what he meant.
Oh.
What's similar about these two things?
Yeah.
And that's partly Sam's fault because him and Voss will chatter on about sneakers for hours on end.
I think Voss got a cool collection.
Yeah.
And then,
yeah.
So then Voss, but they wanted me to go up at the beginning and be like, okay, guys, everybody, this is going to be a show, so let's keep it. I was like, no, let Voss go up cold. Because that's one thing about Voss. He'll go up cold,
right,
and he won't till that audience is. I mean, it was trying to capture the essence of everything. So it's like you can't warm up the show and then have the comedian warm him up. Voss went up dead cold and did what he does. He doesn't play games. You know what I mean? I mean, he'll go in there. And he was, in fact, in true Voss form, after the show, one of the themes of the show was how Chris DiStefano had a tough time. He had to go first, and it was kind of, you know, he bombed, and he was like, I had to warm him up. And then Voss, I was on the phone to how good the show was. He goes, everyone's saying Chris warmed him up. I warmed him up. He was ranting in the background, me and him and Bonnie talking, and he's just screaming about how he warmed him up.
Well, was there anybody sitting outside, or was everybody in their cars?
No, nobody was allowed to sit outside because if you guys remember, earlier, about a month before that, they had a drive-in graduation, and everybody got corona.
So nobody could get out of their cars. Yeah.
Well, yeah. So it was against the whatever New York law, filming law at that time.
Oh, okay. So you couldn't hear any laughs at all.
No, you couldn't hear any.
You heard the horns honking. And you got shots of people like laughing in their cars. But guys, I mean, one of the stars of Colin Quinn and Friends, a parking lot comedy show, has joined us here on the Zoom call. He's the king of Zoom, although I am starting to worry because I would imagine the shed is starting to get very cold. Ladies and gentlemen, Robert Kelly. Robert Kelly's here.
I'm freezing. I'm literally freezing right now.
Why don't you get a heater?
I do have a heater in here. I love that Jim's so rich. He's just like, just get stuff to make it hotter. I'm in a shed, Jim. I'm poor.
No, but I don't think that's going into Howard Hughes territory to say plug in a heater.
Yeah, well.
That's your idea of a rich. How poor were you growing up? Buy a hat. What are you, a millionaire?
First of all, I don't like that Colin Quinn's Mr. Roper hair.
I feel like they got a polite laugh rather than a real laugh, but I could be wrong. I'll take it.
How you doing? Where are you? Hawaii, Jim?
Things are looking up, Helen.
Helen.
Yeah, do you like my background?
I do like your background. Now you just need a few more colors just to come out of the closet.
Oh, yeah, I should probably change that. It's giving the wrong message.
you guys didn't even notice his Chip t-shirt. He's been wearing Chip t-shirts every day. I want to say since definitely August. Way before Halloween. Yes, it's maybe August. And Jim has fallen into the he loves all over print Chip Chipperson t-shirts.
My friend Alex tells me that Chip has been doing the Queen quotes every day, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
This might be a good time to do a little improv. My boy. Oh, I love you despite your philandering ways.
Oh, my son is missing. That's Thatcher. I want to be Thatcher.
You can't be Thatcher. I'll be the queen.
Oh, yeah, Margaret Thatcher. What do you think? They never met?
I said Philip.
I know. And Margaret Thatcher walked in. Philip's busy. Margaret Thatcher was there. She overheard. She came in.
You're updating the routine. The crown is out. Everybody, you know. Yeah, I get it.
And I do a good Margaret Thatcher.
You do.
I was just thinking that.
Yeah.
It doesn't sound at all like Bill Clinton with a British accent.
No, no. It is Margaret Thatcher. I capture her.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, that was pretty good.
My son is missing.
There's a little bit of Edgar in that Margaret Thatcher, though.
There might be. We're going to attack the Falkland Islands, April Falls. Yeah, there's a little bit of Edgar in her.
A little bit of Edgar in all of us.
Yeah. So, Bob, why don't you get a heater? That was my point. Not that
I do have a heater. It's just not. It doesn't work. They don't. You know, it doesn't work as good. It takes like a couple hours for the heat out. So
that little shit, yeah. Really?
Yeah, it's like 25 degrees out. So it's
Plus,
it's not an insulated shed, is it? It's just like a wooden shed.
No, I insulated the whole thing. I did all the work myself.
Are you feeling warm?
That's why you're cold.
This is the problem with us. You understand that all these other comics on the other coast are very friendly with each other and they support each other. We've done nothing but smash each other since I've come in here.
I was just
Mr. Ropehair.
That is true. And then I said, why don't you just get a heater? And he attacked me like I'm fucking Mr. Highfalutin.
No, but he made a good point, Jim. The way you said it was so irritable, it was an attack. You go, why don't you get a heater?
Yeah, why don't you get a heater? You said a very condescending and like rich person from a balcony. All, you said that
it was not rich person from a balcony. It was a person talking to a stupid person. You misunderstood the tone. It was person who knows that a heater makes it warmer.
I mean, you can switch those out. I mean, balcony person talking to a stupid person are very interchangeable.
Yeah, I mean, I want to see you warm as well. I mean, I'm thinking of getting a portable heater myself. I was in Costco looking at them. They're not that expensive.
Why don't you get me one? Next, if you get one, grab me one. Drop it off at the house. Come over for dinner.
Ooh.
I would like to.
Good exchange. The old barter system.
That's right.
Yeah, I mean, Bob, I was thinking about you because you got to be in that shed. I mean, you've committed to doing Calta and Kelly every day, which was nice in the summer. But now that it's cold out, you have to be in the shed every single day through the winter.
Yeah. Yeah, I messed up. I miscalculated.
Miscalculated.
Yeah, I should have. I'm going to have to figure something out. I'm going to have to put some. The thing is, if I put heat in here, then I can get taxed on this footage. Like I'd have to do my stuff. Right now, you can pick this shed up, and I can take it somewhere else. It's not connected to anything, so.
Right.
But I'm gonna have to figure it out because it's really bad in here right now.
Yeah, and you probably would need more than one heater on for a while. There's not 28 degrees. You want to be able to be comfortable doing your show, and those portable heaters break down half the time. So you guys are doing 6 days a week, right?
We're doing Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, five days a week.
That's a hell of a schedule. And it's 1 hour a night and then that live one on Saturday.
We do the jerk off party on Saturday nights where we let all the fans come in to the Zoom. So whoever's a member of the Patreon gets a link and they all get to come in. And that's great. It's pretty fun. Everybody's pretty fun. Yeah. It's a lot of his fans, a lot of my fans, a lot of O&A fans are there. If you guys remember that show.
Yeah.
Is it as fun as you're being right now?
Yeah, Bob, I do want to make mention earlier this week.
We have a lot of laughs and the show's going really well. Jesus Christ. We don't
I don't like the stupid shadow in front of your face. Can you move whatever's in front of your camera?
Yeah, unless it's a gun, then keep it there.
There you go.
He has a ring light that he refuses to set up.
Oh, that's perfect. See, that's showbiz.
I'm doing the rest of the show like this just to show you people what's up.
Do you literally have a little portable light you put on top of your laptop?
No, this is I have two lights. I have a big ring light right here and this one here. This is it's called a cube. Bob knows it's kind of lingo.
I know what it is. He refuses to watch a 5-minute video on YouTube how to set up his lighting.
I did watch it. I watched 10 minutes of video.
And what did you do? Skip past the part where they said microphone?
I have a microphone too right here.
Well, where is it? You're not talking into it.
Why aren't you using it?
Because he doesn't know how to turn it on.
All right. That's it.
So where's your ring light? Let me see your ring light.
I came here to talk about the special, not about this bullshit. You guys want
to be honest. I'm shocked that you have like a real like a light that's meant for this stuff. I honestly thought you just had a desk lamp plugged in next to your computer.
You do whatever
it's
you
not
want.
On. It's not on.
It's not on, man. It's not on.
Yeah, it's not on.
Now we can't hear him at all.
Now he can't hear him at all. He turned it on.
Choose it. You have to choose it in the settings.
Zoom preferences.
Zoom.
Yeah.
Voss and Colin are the only comedians left that don't have mics for these.
Oh no! Keith Robinson's the worst.
No, he doesn't.
Oh, we had Keith on. Yeah, earlier,
into his
yeah,
phone. Into his phone. Did you see that awful echo?
And he literally. This is
Yeti mic. Yeah. Switch to Yeti stereo mic. Okay. Now.
Okay, we don't.
We can't hear you at all.
You had it.
You had it.
You probably have to turn. Maybe you have to turn up the mic. Is the volume on the mic turned down?
My MacBook Air speaker.
Nope.
Oh boy.
You're muting yourself. You're muting yourself.
Yeah, I don't know why.
I changed my MacBook Air speakers to Yeti speakers, but for some reason the Yeti mic speakers doesn't work right now. So we'll just leave it like this.
Okay. Speakers.
Yeah, and you know, it's the microphone, not the speakers.
You changed your microphone, not the speakers.
No, my mic changed, but still, this is a long story. I couldn't hear you, so I don't want to go into
it. I see.
Okay. All right. Better we just leave things as they were.
Let's talk about the special.
Yeah.
Yes. Now,
Colin got very mad at me.
Why?
Because I was taught we were me Rachel. Okay, go ahead. You tell it, Colin.
Bob. He was talking about the special with Rachel and Keith on the pod. They were all on the special. And Bob, like, you know, I literally called him up and said, I'm directing this thing, Bob. He's on the special. He goes, yeah, I like when they cut away from us performing to us backstage. I thought they really did a good job. He's saying they. Right. Like he didn't believe I was the director.
He was using the colloquial term of just people in show business as opposed to the person in front of him who actually did the work.
Yeah,
we figured that
he knows very well. We were basically speaking constantly throughout the whole thing.
He figured that he knows Colin, but he also figured that it must be the decision makers that actually made those good decisions. That Colin wasn't like they put Colin's name on it. But
one of Bob's rather cruel lines, but it had some accuracy to it, was in the middle of the special. This girl Blair was doing a lot of stuff, and Bob goes, hey, I want to talk to the director. I go, I'm the director. He goes, no, the real director, that blonde girl.
I mean,
it's rather hurtful, but it was certainly accurate.
Yeah.
Let's just put it this way. He had a lot of guidance around him. There was a lot of people around him going, do you think we should do that? Really?
Yeah.
So he was the director in name, you think, but there was other people doing all the real things.
Oh, director in name. Yes, I was the director in name. In fact, all those people not in comedy came up with a whole concept of going backstage and cutting back and forth.
I've never been on any set.
I'm talking to Jim Norton right now.
Well, I wasn't there, so don't be mad at me.
I've never been on any set, Jim, ever in my life have I been on a set where the director came up and went, hey, I'm the director, 74 times. No director has ever said I'm the director. We get it. You kept I'm the director. Settle down.
I was proud to be directing.
We got it.
It's exciting.
We got it.
It was exciting. Yeah.
By the way, a lot of fans have been bringing up the other controversy, which is where was Jim Norton? Where was Jim? Supposed to be Colin Quinn and friends. I tried to point out to them that Jim is not a friend.
That's right. We know each other.
Yeah, Jim stopped being friends with us 5 years ago.
That's right.
That's right.
Yes.
Yeah.
It was over.
Jim made that decision. I saw Bill Burr. Now, Bill Burr wasn't a friend of mine. Even when he stopped sitting at the table, I was like, who cares at the time? It was like 2001 or whatever it was. But because Bill was barely at that table.
Right.
But when Jim made that decision, that was it, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Jim dumped us when he dumped Opie.
No.
Jim just cleaned house. He was like, I'm done with that.
That's right. This is the new me. This is my new life, my new experiences. Yeah. And I don't need
that rainbow symbolic.
Yeah. It's very
symbolic. I should change that. You know what? You're right. It's not very rock and roll. I appreciate you guys saying that. I'm going to change that because I don't want to give the wrong
rock and roll. It looks like the Boston album from 1976.
Oh, that's better. How's that?
Oh, huh? Yeah. Flames.
Oh, you don't like the Flames?
I like the rainbow better.
All right. I'll put the rainbow back.
We know.
I'll put the rainbow back. If that's what you really want, if you don't want that, I'll put the rainbow back.
Oh yeah, I got into a little Twitter beef last night with one of the reviewers. Did you see that, Quinn?
No.
Oh boy,
what was one somebody of the reviewers?
Somebody reviewed the thing and they put everybody. They left me out. They didn't put me in it, and they put Todd Barry instead of me.
What?
they tagged everybody and they put Todd Barry nowhere to be found. And somebody sent me the link. Hey man, I thought you were in this. And I retweeted him back. I go, first off, Todd Barry wasn't in it. Second off, I was, you know, something like that. Yeah. There you go.
That's the end of the story.
Yeah. And then he offered to give me his book he wrote a book about somebody. And I was like, yeah, that's not how you get in my good graces with reading.
Yeah. Don't give Bob something he won't know what to do with.
Yeah. Start with chocolate.
Well, did he apologize?
No, he did apologize after I called him out. But yeah, that happens to me all the time in anything we do, even in the promos for the show. Everybody got a promo to promote on their thing of them doing something funny. My promo was Bonnie smashing me on a fat joke.
Were you unhappy with that promo?
If you look, everybody's promo had Bonnie in it. So I think they were a little fucking... it was
It was Colin's decision.
Yeah. Yeah. Colin's
was that your
the director.
Director. Was that your decision?
Well, I'm not really in charge of the promo department, actually. So that I can't take credit for. But I think they made the right decision. I stand behind it.
Back them.
Yep. I mean, Bob, does that drive you crazy? You're in a position where I feel like every time I see you on one of these multi-comedian specials or tours or anything, you're always closing. I feel like people have such great respect for you that they're going to put you on last because you can handle it. And everybody says, Bobby crushes every time. Bobby crushes every time. But then when it comes to the promotion, when it comes to the advertising, when it comes to the announcement, fuck Bob Kelly is the message that I get. And I don't think it's fair.
It really is true. I get a fucking hi-hat every time. Even on that Netflix thing, if you go to Netflix, it's Nikki Glaser, Darnell, Miss Pat, Jim Norton. It's never been Fat Bob.
You're not in the promos?
First of all, Bob's all over this goddamn special.
No. Not this guy.
Whoa. Look at the promo that we put together, the opening promo. It's all Bob. So stop pretending.
Not this.
Yeah, Bob, what are you saying? You're in the promo. You're in the promo. What are you saying?
Not only in the promo, he's the most featured person in the big promo.
No, we're not talking about this one.
Right, so now he's complaining about the promo. No, this one is...
You're acting like it's a general thing.
It's a general thing, right.
You're left out, and I'm trying to explain in the big promo for the show, it's all Bob.
It's all you. Yeah.
And then he's like, well, when they sent me with Bonnie, let's look at reality.
That's right.
That's a good point. That's a great point.
Right, Bob.
You know what, Sam? You know what, both of you, you stink. This is what you do.
What do you mean?
Sam asks a question because he just wants to get Colin mad, and then he sets me up, and then Jim just hey, that's a good point, you two nodding heads. You know what?
Wrestling
commentators. I'm sick of both of you.
Jim and I are invested in the truth. No,
here's the truth. Sam, 1 minute before that, goes, yeah, and it seems to me like it's fuck Bob Kelly. And then I say the other thing, and he goes, that's a good point.
Well, it was. I listen. That's my art.
You're playing both sides
art
of the street, Sam.
I hate your shiny new head.
My talent is listening and being able to, you know, discern. That's all that is.
that's your talent. Okay.
That's where I shine.
That's your talent. Yeah, nice talking to you, Sam. That is. I know, but I think the show was awesome. I thought it was great, and I love my favorite part was the through line with DiStefano, with him bombing. I thought that was because that would be something they would immediately cut out of it and try to you know, they left that in, and then at the end for him to go just literally the end of the show. Thank you. Good night. Every show fades away. Crane shot. They're like, just for the record, I didn't bomb. That was great.
But how could he tell he was bombing even if there's no lat? Was there just no car? How could you tell?
It's the same way. I'll answer this. It's the same way I can tell from this segment you didn't watch the special, Jim, and Sam did.
Oh, you could have just asked me if I watched it. I would have told you no.
Why would you don't have to be a detective watch it? To figure out? Didn't want to be in it.
Well, I was out of town. I couldn't do
it. Out of town.
Yeah, see, the problem was that Voss, as a host, and we talked to Keith about this, and he completely blamed Voss. He said he doesn't like Rich Voss, and he's a bad host.
Yeah.
But Voss didn't really set up how to respond to jokes. Like, you have to honk the horn when you're laughing. So
but he said honk. That up. He said honk, and nobody knew what he meant. Just honk your horns.
He's the worst host. Listen, from him hosting Creeps with Kids, the worst. He thinks he's the best host in the world, too. That's what's mind-boggling. His intros, I can't even believe it. We're finally doing a theater tour. It's what we've talked about. We're selling out. It's amazing. And he brings people up. This next guy, he's good. I like him. He's one of my good friends. I think he's funny. Give it up. What? Colin, how did he bring you up? Colin did a special appearance for us because Florentine couldn't make it. What did he say about you?
He's like, this next guy stinks. He had two specials. He does fucking history specials now. he'll be doing a special about this fucking building probably next year.
You know what Voss's problem is as a host? He's a charmless clod. Voss is a charmless clod.
He really is.
But here's the problem. Is Voss, first of all, when we bust his balls, then every idiot thinks they can go on social media and then trash Voss. Then they get blocked by Voss. Then they get pissed off. So all of you listening, just because we're busting Voss's balls doesn't mean you should jump in and then be shot.
All right. Okay. All right, Tim Dillon. Stop giving speeches. Trying to change the internet. I'm just saying, you're trying to change the way people. Are you going to stop trolls with this speech? Listen, you guys don't do it. We can do it, but you guys don't do it. Just let us do the laughs. That's not how it works. Was it the Tim Dillon line that made you mad?
he just wanted to enjoy the silence, I think.
Yeah. What did Tim Dillon do? I don't even know. I didn't understand the reference. I know Tim, but I didn't know what he said.
Tim gives good speeches.
I mean, I kind of got the reference, but I figured I'd go with the room.
Nice Tim Dillon rant. It's a nice Tim Dillon rant.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. You're going to double down on this bomb? Literally, first of all, it's infuriating because literally the fact that we talked about it 100 times, I'm like, you know what? Maybe it's time to explain that to the audience. And then you take their side, you fucking traitor, you Benedict Arnold. You're like, okay, what are you sticking up for the goddamn trolls? Shut up and join in.
Are you saying that Bob was trying to keep himself as like one of the guys, like one of the regular, like, hey, I'm not like these showbiz fruits. You guys can give me a resin.
No, that's not what I was doing. I'm serious.
I agree with Colin.
It's fucking 30 years later. You should have done it during, like, after Tough Crowd. You're trying to do it.
There was no Twitter.
The end of our career. I'm 50. It's over.
That's a good point.
You should have done it 900 fat jokes ago.
But in light of the special, I just didn't want people going to the special and going, Voss is a hack. Voss is a shitty host.
Yeah.
Right.
Then tell Bonnie not to tweet.
I mean, so far, so far, just this week, Keith Robinson has come on the show to proclaim that Voss is a terrible host. And Bob Kelly has come on the show to proclaim that Voss is a terrible host. Mm-hmm. On your HBO special, Chris bombs because Voss is a terrible host.
That's right.
So for you to have the nerve to now come on here and say people should not say that Voss is a terrible host is really it's counterintuitive, Colin. I don't understand the mixed messaging.
It's not, because the truth is, Voss is not a terrible host. Voss is actually a very good host. Voss was the host. What do you think? I made him the host so he'd suck? He's the host. I mean, do you think they made him the host so he would suck? And he's the host because he's what's good about comedy is a guy like Voss gets up and he's not leaving till he cracks the crowd open.
Yeah. I don't like this defense of Rich Voss. I don't like this new positive attitude.
I was pushed into it because I'm defending the special now.
No, this is not about the special. Yeah, the special, I'm sure, is very good. This is about Voss the person.
You guys put me into the corner where to defend the special, I have to defend Rich. If I don't defend Rich, this whole special crumbles.
But this is the
type of behavior that you were accusing Bob Kelly of being no fun earlier, and now you're doing it by going like, all jokes aside, Rich Voss is actually really great. And if Bob had done that, you would have said he was no fun.
Well, guess what?
Don't fall for it, Colin. Do not fall for it.
What?
Do not. Listen, even though I should let you fall right into Sam's trap.
Am I wrong?
I should. But you know what? I'm going to make up for that Tim Dillon bomb. Don't fall for it. Don't even respond to his horseshit.
What do you mean?
You understand me? You're the director, goddammit.
What are you talking about?
What are you talking about? You know Sam's lying. He's up to sneaky shit when he starts talking about sentences. What are you talking about?
He's talking about you playing the long game, and we don't like it.
The one thing about the special that was weird is that it went from day to night.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's uncommon.
The daytime. I wish you were grabbing your heart for real. The special, the people that went up during the day, I think was a little harder.
Yeah,
absolutely.
To go up,
yes,
with the, you know, all that visual behind you at night, it was, everything was dark, it looked beautiful, it was a little easier because it was all on you.
So how long was the shoot?
You had boats. What's that?
How long did it take to shoot it?
I don't know how long, director Colin.
I mean, we were there for about 6 hours.
Okay.
Yeah.
Hey, Jim.
Yeah.
I'm not a radio guy.
Yeah.
But you are. You've been doing this for 20 fucking years.
Yeah.
You can't ask a question, and when the person gives you the answer, you can't just stare off and go, oh. That doesn't sound like good radio.
Yeah, yeah, well, when you're rubbing your cock with your thumb during the show.
But no, I wanted to just, I was just curious. I didn't really have a follow up for it.
Look at Sam laughing. Sam has been fucking dealing with this for 2 years.
It wasn't a great question.
Isn't the contract up right now?
No, we have till October. But no, you don't. Yes. I didn't have a great bang up follow up question, but it was just I was just curious about the information. I didn't, you know, how long?
But you 6 hours. Then right, stare cool. off into the horizon and just go, oh.
Yeah. This isn't the actor's studio, stupid. Say something funny. Keep it going.
All right. So it took 6 hours. Now, did you shoot it? I was trying to think about it. Did you shoot it where you did all the stand-up, or would you just kind of keep cameras going on everybody the entire time?
No. Well, we got the cameras on people as much as we could, but I wish we could have got them the whole time. We missed a couple of zingers, but there was a lot of good shit in there.
See, the whole thing was, I was shocked that you shot during the day, but then you said 6 hours, and it kind of made sense. You couldn't have shot at 8 o'clock. At night and shot yeah, no. 6 hours.
There was a lot of daytime stuff, but a lot of funny banter. Bob and the boys really came through because they showed up. Bob showed up loaded for bear because he was already pissed at Keith because Keith made him wait. Bob went to pick up Keith. Bob, tell the story. He goes to pick up Keith.
I actually told Keith an hour earlier because I knew he would be late.
Yeah.
He's,
where'd you go to pick him up?
At the cellar. I told him I would be, let's meet at whatever, 5, you know, but I really didn't need to meet him till 6. But I knew he would be late. And so I showed up at 6. He still made me wait like 40 minutes. He was drinking wine and ordered like fucking food at the cellar. And he's like, nah, just, and he pulls that shit where it's like, just 5 minutes, just wait, relax. You got to learn to relax. Like some fucking old guy shit. Like, and then I'm waiting. And finally I go, dude, I'm out. And he goes, ah, forget it. He didn't even get his food. We left. We're late. Then he tries to tell me how to go to Brooklyn. Like, he fucking is a new comic and he goes to Brooklyn. He hasn't been in Brooklyn in 40 years. And I got three GPSs, Waze, Google, and iPhone telling me to go this way. But you want me to listen to you.
Right.
You're drunk. You've literally already gotten drunk at the Cellar.
And then why would you have waited for him? You should have made him Uber.
We were supposed to pick up Rachel, and he forgot to tell me. we pull up at the set, and she's like, you guys coming? I'm like, what? She goes, Keith said you were picking me up on the way. I go, never told me that. We're already here.
I don't understand why everybody's picking everybody up.
The whole way there, he was heckling Bob's driving.
Oh.
He was cursing Bob out, going, look at you, stink. Yeah, make that turn, you dummy. He's just abusing him.
Literally yelling at me the whole fucking way there. And then I'm taking the wrong way. Every turn I took, you stupid. You should have went this way.
So what I'm saying is it put Bob in the perfect mindset when he showed up on the set. He came in hot, the way we like it.
Yeah,
special. He was already there.
And I was so mad because we had to park a little far away from the set, you know, and he had to walk, so it took an extra 30 minutes for him walking over cobblestone Brooklyn streets. I was so fucking annoyed. The camera, they have it on film. We were walking up, and they have cameras just waiting for us. And I just turned around and went, hurry up! And you see Keith with a bag.
Brooklyn Navy Yard?
No, I don't know. Not the Navy Yard. It was in Greenpoint. It was like a studio they were using as a studio. It was an old warehouse area.
It was awesome.
Wait till you see Jim. I mean, you think your backdrop looks nice. Wait till you see this backdrop.
I've seen clips of it. It looked great.
It's breathtaking.
Were the waves as distracting for people as they said it was? Especially during the daytime, it felt like the first few comics going up there were like really distracted by the waves behind them.
No, when you got laughs, you didn't really hear the waves.
Okay, so really distracting for Chris then. Really tough for Chris.
Well, you know, it was great at night though, because they shot. On the building next to you, they shot you. So that was I don't know who made that decision, but they there was a beautiful whoever made that decision. They shot because it's a drive-in, so they had the drive-in, but it was the show, so the people in the car could watch the show and that. It was beautiful. I don't know if Blair made that decision or the set design, whoever made that, the DP, that was a great idea. So,
during the day, they didn't do that. Just at night, the comics got that.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Yeah.
And Colin closed, by the way. Colin went up at the end because I told him when we were doing, I go, can you please? I don't ever, anytime I've ever done one of these shows, it's always been some company or whatever. And I always got to go last. I go, you're one of my best friends. This is the only opportunity I'll have to say, can you please? Give me a sweet spot. Give me a nice spot. He goes, I will think about it. And then, of course, 2 days before, I go, where am I going? He goes, last. But then he wound up actually going last. But he said last and laughed about it. He did it intentionally.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then but he went up at the end and he actually closed it out, he killed. So.
You know, in the beginning of the special, in the beginning of the special, when there's like footage of people filing in and everything, and the cars driving in, there is. I had to rewind it to double check. There's a great shot of Jim and Mai's radio agent shoveling a sandwich in his face.
Was Tony there?
Tony was there. Eating sandwiches in his car, and he was very distraught by his portrayal. Because he said it was inaccurate that he was not just shoveling food in his face.
He was hunched over and he literally pushed the sandwich into his face. Just pushed it into his face.
Yeah. We were texting. He hadn't seen it, so I just sent him a screenshot when I watched it. And I was like, hey, you're on HBO. And he was not happy. He said
he wasn't pleased with his portrayal.
He said it was a very inaccurate portrayal of his evening. He said there was another family with him, and they were all sharing a lovely dinner, that it was not just him shoveling sandwiches in his face in his car.
Good for you. Yeah, good for you to leave that.
It was really fun though to shoot it because it was that usually when you shoot that shit, you know, when you're off stage, you'll kind of go your own way and get your shit together and kind of get your head right and yeah. you'll yeah. have your space. So everybody will kind of separate, but the cameras were around the whole time. So you had no time to get into that. I got to go on stage shit. You kind of had to because you were fucking being attacked and, you know, talking about shit and Colin was bringing things up and there was a camera on the whole time. So there was no alone time. It was like talking, performing. And then you're up next. So that was actually, it was cool, but it was scary. And then just before I went up, I think my chair broke.
Of course it did.
I hate those director's chairs. They're not meant for chubby people. my little chubby feet are dangling.
Yeah, I hated missing that. I hated it.
Yeah, that was it. Was
yeah,
it was
and everybody
really
was doing
fun.
Like everybody was doing new stuff too, right? Wasn't that part of the?
It had to be
ask
yeah.
anyway. Yeah.
Yeah, because topical material. When, you know, just by the surroundings, it had to be. Another right. good decision on my part, by the way, now that I think about it.
Well, yeah, they thought yeah. that it would be good to
I
do new
I should be
material.
Directing all stand-up specials and getting big money for it. That's just a fact. Okay. Jim, I don't know how you're fixed financially right now, but if you ever do another special, I'd appreciate I'll call your agent when he's not stuffing his face.
I would love you to direct my special, and I could probably, you know, the merchandise store, funny segue, has been a hit. So now I think that I could afford to finance and have a real director.
How does that make you feel?
Prince Philip.
Oh, there you go. How good does that look on Bob?
Bob's wearing the Chip Chipperson mask. Colin, how does that make you feel as a potential director that the budget for you directing a comedy special is coming together through the sale of Chip Chipperson merchandise?
I would, well, as a director, I would obviously emphasize the merch table, you know.
Right,
that's right.
And, yeah, I think that could be an important segue into the world of Chip.
I got yelled at for a Chip shirt.
What's that?
Really?
I was in a store with Max, and there was this old lady, two old ladies in the store. And I was walking around, and I got scared because as I was leaving, she's like, "What's that shirt?" Like, kind of yelled at me. I'm like, it's just this comedian guy. I panicked.
That's how you describe a juggernaut?
You panicked and gave her misinformation when you said it's this comedian guy.
Yeah, I would love to hear like how people generally describe, because people have to come up to them. There's enough Chip shirts being sold that there is a national conversation going on where people come up to people and they go, "Hey, what's that shirt all about?"
Yeah.
And then you have to explain Chip to strangers.
Yeah.
Hey, you just say from the twisted mind of Jim Norton.
Yeah.
Well,
are you making a lot of money off the Chip merch?
You do okay, but you have to pay for all. It's a whole thing. So it's like, you know, your expenses
you?
Are pretty high. What do you mean?
Who's you?
Whoever's doing it. I mean, your expenses are high.
Jim.
Jim. Yeah.
The correct answer to that was none of your business.
No, I don't mind. I don't mind telling Bob. I'm happy to chat with Bob. But I'm saying is it's deceptive because you have to pay for everything. And like, it's a weird setup, a system. I would explain it to you.
Okay? See, Bob, that means he's making a lot of money. Whenever the guy goes, there's a lot of expenses. That means
no, dude, it's not what. Anytime they go, it's not what you think. It's not what you think. It's, you know, I mean, I do all right, but not as good as you think I do.
Yeah, yeah, it's going good. People are buying the stuff. They like it.
Good. Well, look. There you go.
Well,
Colin Quinn and friends.
Not to do your job, but this segment was over 12 minutes ago. Can you wrap it up?
I mean, I was trying to plug you, but I was rudely interrupted.
Well.
Colin Quinn and friends, a parking lot comedy show. It's up now. It's on HBO Max. Now. Look, this is a great time. I mean, you get HBO Max, you're going to get Wonder Woman at Christmas, and you're going to get Colin Quinn and Friends, a parking lot comedy show today. So, I mean, if you're not subscribed already, get on it.
Yes.
Thanks, guys.
Yeah.
Great. And I'll be at Uncle Vinny's tomorrow night. There's only, I think it's 40 seats.
All right. So that's cool. You'll do at least.
I'm going to see if Voss will stop by so I can sell some tickets.
Yeah, it was Voss.
Are you sold out at Cousin Vinny's?
I want to call from. I demand a call from Voss later today. I heard you were defending me.
No, you know what? I apologize. Go ahead. Tell the fans again what not to do. Yeah, do it. I apologize. You're right. Tell them what not to do.
You're still sticking with this?
Yeah.
It bombed twice. Now you're going for a hat trick?
Yeah, you are trying to salvage the Tim Dillon moment into a laugh as we leave.
Hat trick is three times, not two.
Yeah, I said now you're going for a hat trick.
Yeah, he said you bombed twice. You're going for a hat trick.
Oh, sorry. I fucked up. Two plus one. Four times now. Oof. Yeah. Look at it. It's cold in the shed. I'm a little cold.
Yeah. Fucking. All right, Bobby. Colin.
You go warm up.
Hi, guys.
You go warm up. We have Nick DiPaolo joining us next.
Yes.
Yeah, he's going to be funny.
Bye, guys.
Yes, he will.
Bye, guys.
See you guys later. Bye. Thank you. And we're going to take a real quick break.
Take a single,
Single break, And we'll be right back.
Be right back.
More Jim Norton and Sam Roberts after this. Jim Norton and Sam Roberts are back.
Do I look dark?
Yes.
I do.
You do.
A little bit.
Yeah. Welcome back, everybody.
Yep. Jim Norton and Sam Roberts.
What's going on?
Nick DiPaolo is joining us. Nick DiPaolo, of course, you know him from his show, The Nick DiPaolo Show. It airs for free Monday through Thursday at 5 p.m. on YouTube. Nick is also going to be live from the Plaza Hotel and Casino in Las Vegas this Saturday. And you'll be able to watch along at thecomicsgym.com, G-Y-M. Thecomicsgym.com this Saturday, 10 p.m. Eastern. You'll be able to see Nick DiPaolo live from the Plaza Hotel and Casino in Las Vegas. What's going on, Nick?
What up, fellas? And I guess there's another link, watchlivenow.com, that they can go to.
That Comics Gym, Florentine is doing something for them like weeks down the road, I think.
And the week after.
Oh, it's the week after.
The week after.
Yep. So I guess that they're like making a push now to do live comedy specials.
Yeah, it's not even a special. It's just it's a night of comedy, but it's in front of a live audience and we're streaming it. So, you know, the world is the audience, hopefully. but we Tommy has this beautiful room out in Vegas where I'm doing it. There'll be about 250 people there. And I don't know, this might be the foreseeable future if we keep this fucking COVID hoax up. I don't know.
Have you been on stage or no?
I have been on stage a few times. I went months and months without, but the last 2 months, Jimmy, I've been on probably five times, I think, five or six times. And, you know, I reached the capacity. Some of these clubs, Huntsville, Alabama, Zanies in Nashville, were, you know, I had about 150 people. They hold about 300 or whatever, and they can let 50% in or whatever. It was fine, you know. No social distancing. You're all fucking sitting right next to each other, and I didn't see one mask on the whole weekend.
So I haven't been on stage in 8 months, which I got stuff booked now, I think, for April, but it feels really weird to have not been on for that long. Like, I never thought in my career I'd go that long without doing a set. You know, I'm worried about going back on now.
Yeah, it's weird. My first one back, I think, was a Gunk with Maine at Jonathan's, and I couldn't remember any of the shit I had written all the shit right after my last special, and then this thing hit. And like you, I didn't go on for about 6-7 months, and you know, my set's a mess, and I'm winging it 5 minutes at a time where I couldn't remember my bits, and somehow you get through it with all your experience, you know. But it, yeah, it's kind of weird, and it's a weird feeling, because, and especially you, Jimmy, because I know you never miss a night, you know. But it's a fucking, but you know, it comes back quick, but
yeah.
What a weird time, I'll tell you.
Yeah, it's got to be, I guess, if the audience knows that you're doing it too, like, hey, look, I haven't been on in months. I mean, maybe there's a certain level of tolerance they have, like, yeah, all right, we'll watch somebody come back to something he hasn't done in 7 months.
Yeah, you know, that's the first thing I said every night. I get up there and I said, look, thanks to COVID, I haven't been on in about 7 months. So if this sucks, blame the chinks. Anyways, I mean, the Chinese. The Democrats.
Do you not believe this?
Well, I believe there's something called COVID-19, and I believe it's about as powerful as the flu. From age one, and I'm following the science, like the jerk-offs always say, from age one to 69, your chances of surviving it are 99.96%. So it's not the goddamn yellow fever. It's not the plague of 1880. It's ridiculous. You know, if you're if you have diabetes and you're a 92-year-old Chinese woman, stay the fuck home.
Well, what about the people who are worried about, like, their parents getting it, right? Like, I don't want it going everywhere because my parents are in, you know, they're in decent health, but they're old. So if they get sick, that goes quick. And they got, yeah. My parents got 10 years or more, probably more left, yeah. Unless they get COVID. And then they get 10 minutes.
Well, I suggest you Zoom them on Thanksgiving. Make a nice Moderna vaccine gravy for them. I don't know what to tell you. Just, you know, my mother's 84. Christ, I've been making out with her for 3 weeks. Nothing's happened.
Now, will you take the vaccine?
I don't know. Only if it's a 22-year-old nurse putting it into the head of my pee-pee. I don't know. Yeah, I'll take, I guess. I've flown about 8 times. At the end of February, we were right in the middle of this when, they started closing comedy clubs down. And I had 2 gigs left. Somehow Tommy talked these clubs into doing them. both weekends I had the connecting flights, which means when you add up going there and coming back, I was on 8 different planes. And and I was in Chicago after the show, and this is absolutely true. Everybody was panicking about this. I shook about 200 hands after the show. Then I went in the green room and I said, whose slice of pizza is that? And they go, you can have it. I just picked it up and ate it without washing my hands. And
what are you doing, Nick?
I woke up. I forgot. I was so excited. The place was packed. I that night, the next night I get home to Georgia, and I get up to take a piss in the middle of the night. My teeth are chattering, and I was soaked. I was soaked through my sheets, my pillow, and I have never, my teeth were chattering like this. And then the next 2 nights, I sweat through my sheets again, and then I felt fine. And I went to urgent care, and they didn't even have the COVID tests yet. But they said, yeah, you probably, I told them my symptoms, and the guy was laughing, you know. They just tested me for the regular flu, and I had like a slight temperature. But they said, "Yeah, you probably get a dose of it." So I really believe I did, because I've never had chills like that in my life. And then the last month, I've had chills and a slight fever that just went away this past week. So I don't know. I don't know what to tell you. I'm not saying this doesn't exist, but I'm just saying they're blowing it way out of proportion. If these friggin' masks work so much, if these you believe these masks work in preventing it, why are you so nervous if I don't have one on and you have one on?
You know,
why are people still getting it? In the states where masks are mandatory, the numbers are just as high as anywhere else.
The masks stop it from going out.
No, it doesn't.
So when people, oh, okay.
No, it doesn't.
I didn't know.
Oh. No, it doesn't. Put on, and Sam, you could do this. Do you have a vape?
I don't vape, but I know what you're saying.
Yeah, put a mask on and vape or smoke a cigarette. You blow the smoke right through the mask.
Then the insurgents do wear them, though. Like, I don't, surgeons wear them, which is to protect the person they're operating on.
Oh, yeah. Surgeons always wear them, even before COVID. But, you know, as far as it being transferred as an aerosol, I'm not, this is my opinion. These are doctors that or, you know, specialize in epidemiology, and they're laughing at some of this shit. You see people in their cars by themselves wearing a mask. This is all a pretext. This is all a pretext to electing Biden. This has all been done before. If you read your Illuminati books, all this crap, this pictures of Fauci when he was young, standing next to Bill Gates' dad, who's a, you know, a serpent. It's Gavin Newsom's a shapeshifter. They're fucking creepy.
But what creepy about the rest people of the? I don't disagree that there's a lot of shitty things that go on, or a lot of dirty people in that in Washington. But what about the rest of the world? I mean, they're dealing with this everywhere. It's not just here. That's why I don't think it's a Biden tie-in, because it's happening everywhere.
Well, it's happening everywhere because China wants to dominate the world. They shut down their flights right away, if you remember, when it started in Wuhan. But they continued to send flights to the United States, to Europe, and everywhere else.
So this is not just about getting a new person in office. We're thinking global. Well, no, conspiracy.
They used it. They use Rahm Emanuel's best quote. Never let a crisis go to waste. And that's just what they did. They use it as a pretext to keep people away from the polls. And it worked beautifully. I really believe that. The more I read this stuff, it's ridiculous.
So do you think that Trump won the election?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And the more and more stuff that's coming out, it's unbelievable what's coming out right now. And Dershowitz, who's pretty smart, he said, look, he can win this in the courts. He just said this morning or yesterday. But there's, you know, there's limited time. But I mean, come on, guys. I mean, votes were showing up in the middle of the night, like 23,000 votes, and they were all for Biden. And this Dominion, this company that did the software, I mean, they've used this in Venezuela and everywhere else. And now Michigan today, these two Republican people were on the council, the voting council, were bullied into certifying the election. They were promised, but there would be an audit, and then they had no intention on doing the audit, so now they took back their vote. So it's not certified in Michigan right now. I mean, there's a ton of stuff coming out.
So you think Michigan and
Wisconsin, and you look at the swing states, it's where all the dirtiness went on. I mean, I think it's pretty obvious. It's going to be weird. I mean, what's going to happen? If, let's say, Trump did win this in the courts or whatever, I mean, what's going to happen? You thought the riots were bad?
I honestly don't think he will. It's just too many different places. And they keep saying, like, yeah, there's this evidence. And then, you know, I don't see it. Like, Rudy, I haven't seen him present anything that there's a few irregularities here and there, but I haven't seen anything that was concrete or made me go like, yeah, this is definitely.
Well, yeah, because it takes a few days to put a court case together. They can't just, you know, they can't have somebody following me around with a camera and going, look here, look there. You have to put a case together and make a case in court, I guess. That's why time is of the essence. That's what Dershowitz just said. But there's a ton of irregularities.
I've seen a few, and maybe I haven't seen them, but I haven't seen anything that made me think it was like, yeah, this is absolutely a widespread.
Now,
because I keep hearing it, and I don't trust the press either. I mean, I don't trust them. I don't have any reliability on them. I'm just going by the courts striking things down. But then again, this one went through. You know, I'm willing to let it play out. I'm okay with that. Yeah, let it play out.
Yeah, exactly. The media's, you know, the media's already calling him president-elect. I mean, they can't wait to push it through because they know a ton of dirty shit went on, a ton of stuff. It's going to come out. I mean, it's going to come out. It takes a few days to gather all this stuff. But I mean, hundreds of thousands of votes.
Does Alan Dershowitz think that Trump won, or does he think that Trump can win in court? Because like Alan Dershowitz was like, oh, OJ could win in court. But I don't think Alan Dershowitz actually thought that OJ didn't do it. You know what I'm saying?
You'd have to ask him. But in this case, I think it's different than something like a murder. But it has to do with electors and stuff. And if there's enough evidence, and the people that in these states, the electors say, "Hey, something's fishy here," that's winning. I mean, but you know. If Dershowitz believes it, I sort of tend to believe it. But, yeah, I know what you're saying. But, I mean, all week I've been doing these stories. 420,000 votes should have went to Trump in Pennsylvania. I mean, come on. He was up 700,000 votes the night of, and then they stopped counting. That's never happened before. And then you look at all the 12 seats the Republicans picked up in the House. So everybody voted red down at the bottom of the ballot, but at the top of the ticket, they voted blue. That doesn't work out that way. And then you had turnouts in Milwaukee of 95% in some counties, which the average turnout in counties across the country is 50 to 60%. Come on, something stinks.
You know, the reason I believe because that was a question that was raised too, where how could he lose there, but they vote Republican? Trump inspires a tremendous, and I don't hate Trump at all, but he inspires people. He's a very, very polarizing person. So absolutely, he got the second most votes in history. The fact that he motivated that many people to vote for him, but there's also, he motivated a lot of people to vote against him who might not have voted. Like, people have really strong feelings about Trump, and people who might not be motivated to vote hate him. And a lot of Republicans hate him because he was outside the system. He said that there's a lot of Republicans that want to see him go. So I think he motivated people. I think the fact that Biden, let's say it pans out and this is what it is. I think the fact that if Biden got 5 million, the most votes in history, is a tribute to how polarizing Trump is. The fact that that many people went out and voted for him and that many people went out and voted against him.
Well, I'd believe that if Biden was a viable 65-year-old man with all his marbles. But you put that on top of it, everybody knows. And looking back on it, you're like, oh, that's why he wasn't campaigning. He actually knew he had these people working for him. I mean, you can't argue the history of Philadelphia, places like Philadelphia and Chicago, the history of trying to steal elections is ridiculous. And you look back on it, you go, oh, Biden, that's why he was standing in the bay. He made it, you know, showed his face once every 3 weeks or whatever. He actually said, I think he misspoke. He said, what did he say in one clip? He said, we have the strongest something voting fraud organization put together. It almost sounded like he was admitting it was fraud. I think he misspoke. It was like a Freudian slip. But there's too much evidence. Even if Trump doesn't get a second term, he has done this country a service, because it really isn't about just Trump and Biden. It's about cleaning this mess up. I mean, it is loaded with fraud across the country. So for, you know, future elections, we have to have some standards. You can't stop counting in the middle of the night. And what was it? Something 240,000 votes showed up in Michigan in the middle of the night. And it's just, I'm reading article after article, and they can't be making this stuff up. Because you can verify it very easily, the numbers. And James O'Keefe, did you see him send that kid into the polling places undercover?
I never watch any of those.
Georgia.
From either side. I know that, what is it, Project Veritas?
Called?
Yeah, that guy does very interesting undercover stuff. I never watch any of that stuff, though, because I never know. Like, I'll watch something, and I've seen it on both sides, where I'm like, wow, that looks really fucking devastating. And then I realized, like, then you're like, no, this is what it was. And you're just like, oh, fuck, it wasn't. I never know what to believe.
I watch him all the time, and this stuff seems to pan out, but nothing's ever done about it. But they had a guy standing next to a woman in Georgia, and he stood next to her for 2 minutes, and in the three minutes, she made three mistakes favoring Biden, where somebody had to correct her and said, no, that goes in this pile. I mean... And then when the pollster moved closer to her, she went like this, real sarcastic, like, oh, look, I'm looking at it. And then at the end, she goes, hey, the fucking taxpayers pay me to do this. Get away from me. And how about not letting the pollsters, and you can verify this, get within 6 feet of watching people count ballots? You can't see what's going on 6 feet away on a ballot where the print is this big. I mean, to me, there's overwhelming evidence. And like I said, maybe it won't be enough as far as votes go for Trump. But something has to be done to clean up the way we vote. You know what I mean? They have to clean it up. There's no, even people on both sides are saying that. So
I think the Supreme Court won't help him either. I think the Supreme Court won't help. I think he's going to be disappointed. I don't think Brett Kavanaugh will help. I don't think the Supreme Court will. If they have a choice, I don't think they'll do anything.
Yeah, you can't rely on Roberts turned out to be a wolf in sheep's clothing. I wouldn't trust the Supreme Court either. Or some of the people, or some of the Republicans, you know, because he came in and he did what he said. He was going to expose Washington for what it was. And I think he did the country a service, especially with the media, but definitely with this, how dirty it is. And why would you doubt the Democrats after 2.5 years of Mueller-gate that turned up nothing, after a fake impeachment, after what they did to the Kavanaugh hearing? Why would you underestimate their ability to do something nefarious to steal an election?
I don't trust any of them. I don't think there's any of them.
Oh, give me some examples, Jimmy, of the right being that filthy. I mean, you know, I mean, when's the last time, other than Bill Clinton and his blowjob, which I even disagree with.
Yeah, I mean, I can't find any examples of anybody stealing an election beforehand. Like, I can't see. I just find them all to be equally the same. They're all the same. They're all people in the same club. It's like two divorce lawyers arguing. They are closer to each other than they are to either of their clients. They're the same. I look at them that way.
Yes and no. I mean, I see where you're coming from. There's definitely people in the GOP who are having their pockets lined by people in Silicon Valley. And as far as breaking up big tech, they want nothing to do with it either. So, to that degree, I absolutely agree. But you can't tell me there isn't a difference between, Rudy Giuliani and... I don't know, pick a lawyer for Biden. But, they're all in the same club, but Trump sort of exposed it all.
Trump is a different case because he's not a politician. And that's what I liked about him, too. He's not a politician. But the idea that I don't find any of them to be commendable. I don't like Ron DeSantis. I don't like any of them. I don't like Gavin Newsom. I think they're all the exact same.
He's a serpent.
They're all terrible. I don't find any of them to be, and maybe I'm doing broad, I don't find any of them to be like, hey, this group is honorable and this group isn't honorable. They're all the same to me.
Well, I just, from what I read and what I research, there's a lot of Democrats seem to be more power hungry and they've made it clear they don't believe anything in the Constitution and they want this thing to, turn into a socialist shithole, and that's been their goal for years. Look at identity politics. That doesn't come from the right. Political correctness doesn't come from the right. So
identity politics, I mean, MAGA's identity politics.
How yeah. so?
People base their whole identity around being Trump supporters. I mean, that's kind of the definition.
They're not the ones that cry racist every 2 minutes or sexism or, I mean... They just want to go to work. Most people on the right have family and kids. They're not on their bed blogging till 4 a.m. They're not the one. You can't tell me you think that the Republicans traffic in identity politics as much as the Democrats do. Everything is identity with the Democrats. Everything. They don't even look at you as a person. It's black versus white, gay versus straight, the whole transgender bathroom crap, all that stuff. I don't see that coming from the right.
I have to agree with – I find both of them to do it. Political correctness has nothing to do with the Republicans. And the free speech is much more of a conservative strong point now than it is
right,
liberal.
Right.
But I think that MAGA is – it's not – it is people just like, I'm a Trump supporter, which is fine. But, I mean, I do think it becomes a person's – and I do think the mask is a political thing for some people. They feel like, hey, this defines who I am. I think it's the same.
Right.
I think that's
but
an American
but that's not
thing.
What I call identity politics. I'm talking about calling, you know, hate speech and this legislation that where they get in your head to try to, you know, tell you why you punched a gay guy, stuff like that. I mean, the Democrats have been trafficking in that forever. I've never really seen a liberal personality get in trouble, like Tracy Morgan when he had his first baby, saying if it was gay he would have killed it, and he still has a career. It can't the culture. All that crap doesn't come from the right. That's what I call identity politics. And they can paint us old white guys as the you know, evil and we're the problem. That's what I'm talking about. You can't get away from it. Every 2 seconds when they lose an argument, you're racist, you're sexist. That's identity politics. And passing legislation to safe spaces for black kids on campus. That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah, colleges have always been unrealistic. Like when you look at a college, they've always been that way. They've gotten worse. But and Carlin said that once, had the censorship's all coming from the left and from college campuses. But it did cost Kevin the Oscars. I mean, you know, Kevin was supposed to host the Oscars, and he did, I guess, gay jokes years ago, It cost him the Oscars. I mean, the comics are kind of getting it. Chappelle gets a beating every time he does a special, but he just doesn't care. But I mean, come after him. They come after him and they criticize him.
Yeah, after he got $40 million in the bank and was doing stuff on his Comedy Central show that you and I would get arrested for, he still has a career. I mean, we can't even attempt to say stuff like that on the right. I mean, you know, it's one sided. The mainstream media is a propaganda arm for the Democrat Party, and they're all in bed together. Same with social media. I mean, look at what goes on at Twitter. I got frozen out of Twitter 3 years ago. YouTube kicked me off for a week because I was talking about COVID being, you know, making fun of the mask and stuff. They said I was undermining the World Health Organization. That was the reason for kicking me off for a week. The right doesn't do that to the left.
No,
I mean, that's got to feel pretty good for you, though, to know that you have enough power that you can undermine the World Health Organization.
No, that's what I said, Sam. I said, yeah, me, a comic, you know, who's, you know, never played more than 800 people. All of a sudden, I have blood on my hands. Like killing old people like Andrew Cuomo.
How are you liking where you are?
So I did take it as a compliment.
you must love it down there.
Jimmy, I'll tell you, man, I kicked myself in the ass that I didn't. And I always think of the day when I went in to do you. This was the final straw when I went in to do Chip Chipperson show. I live in Westchester. You wanted me there at like, I don't know, 6 or whatever. And it used to take me about, if no traffic, about an hour and 10 minutes to get to this village. That day, it took me 2 hours and 5 minutes. And I was, this is after commuting for 19 years, and I was friggin', I'm like, I look back on it, I can't believe I sat on the Sawmill Parkway for like, yeah. I mean, I went down to the cellar for what, 20 years, sitting in that mess. And I just absolutely love it down here. It's, the airport is, you know, 17 minutes from my house. This studio is 9 minutes from my house. There's no traffic. You go to a beautiful bar. Now there's no people in, but you don't have to wait for anything. It's just convenient living. And thanks to the way this business has gone, we can do it from anywhere.
You were ahead of the curve. I feel like I was thinking about that last night, that the everybody is now getting out of the cities. Like everybody's leaving LA, everybody's leaving New York, and you were there way before COVID. You were gone.
Yeah, I'd like to say I knew something about COVID coming, but I didn't. I just got lucky on that one. But I had had enough. Jimmy, no, Colin used to laugh when I get to the cellar, I'd be all frazzled because of the traffic, and he'd go, "It's New York. Why do you get upset every night that there's traffic?"
And I'm Anthony's going down there now. Anthony is looking in South Carolina,
I think. Yeah. And it's beautiful, Jay. I mean, this town of Savannah is just gorgeous. And it's nice. There's colleges near here, so there's a young element. Restaurants, nice restaurants all over the place. You get the river down there. Riverboat gambling and at night I live like on a main street, a beautiful main tree lined street. You could lay in front of my house in the street after 8 o'clock and not get hit by a car. It's quiet and people, it's 60% black, 40% white. Everybody gets along and it's just, you know, they've been integrated longer down here. So you don't see color. You just deal with people. It's really, really, I tell you, you know me.
You love it.
I really wish I did it like 5-6 years ago.
I can't see myself leaving the city, but the more people that move and the more people that leave, like, yeah, maybe a house, not now, but maybe sooner or later. It's something I don't think is crazy anymore. Where at one point I was like, fucking never, I'll never do it. But now, yeah, I don't know. Maybe I see, especially now with Ant leaving New York, I'm like, fuck, he loves it here. And if he's going to go.
Oh, he's had enough. He's
yeah, had enough. Yeah.
Just, you know, when I was at, look, I was living in Westchester in a very nice house. So my property taxes in that town were $25,000 a year. I come down here and they're $3,000 a year. And, you know, a pack of cigarettes is $5 as opposed to what, 16 in New York. And it's like, it feels like it's 1972 down here in the town that I grew up in. You see people going to church dressed up and It's I don't know. Everybody waves to each other. It has a very different vibe to it. And people who come here to visit say the same thing after a couple of days. There's something palpable, something very different about it, you know? I feel like it's a hidden gem. But it wasn't always this way. I guess it was a mess back in the 70s with crime and everything.
Do you do your show 5 days a week? You just go into the studio 5 days a week?
Four. Yeah, Monday through Thursday. We do it at like 1 in the afternoon, then we drop it at 5 p.m. Eastern at nickdip.com. And, yeah, it's just, you know, I prepare it at night, laying on my bed with my cell phone. And, yeah, I come in at around 11:30, make some more notes, do some more reading, and then we record it. And I got to be honest, I feel so lucky. You must too, Jimmy, with this whole COVID thing. And with comics who don't have a podcast that makes any money or don't have a radio, right. This is a great gig to have in these conditions, is it not? I mean,
radio. We talk about it a lot. Like, yeah. It's I feel really lucky to be able to do, to be able to work in the job that we do. Like, it's not like I had to go and find another fucking vocation. It's like, yeah, this is what I was doing before. I'm just doing it from home. And I love that we can do it from home now. I love it. Sam will stay home forever. I want to go back into the studio, but I'm okay for as long as it takes just to be where we are here. I'm okay with this.
Well, you have a rainbow behind you. You are very lucky. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I was going to change that before you came in, but I thought, no, I got to stay consistent.
I thought it was LGBT week or whatever. And this is how stupid I am. I was thinking you guys were in the studio at Sirius just now.
Really?
Yeah, no.
Yeah.
Oh,
I forgot you guys don't go into the studio.
Not in eight
not
months.
Not at all. I haven't been in since March.
Well, that's if they, you know, a radio studio. Can you think of a better place to keep a COVID germ alive?
Yeah, the microphones. And the thing is, by the way, you're of all the comics, I think you have the best. Colin, we had on before, has the worst setup. Like literally a mic that he can't plug in, he can't keep. Oh. It's crazy watching him just kind of yell, and he forgets that on Zoom, the sound like cuts out if there's a laugh.
Yeah.
So you have a great, lighting is bad. Like, it's terrible. His lighting is terrible.
It's really bad.
Yeah, I got lucky, man. I found this guy when I was on. He was a big Opie and Anthony fan, Jimmy, and I think I was doing Comey's show, and I was talking about I need somebody to set me up. This is after I was doing it in my house, before I was doing it in my house, and this guy sent an email a couple of weeks early when I was O&A saying, I can help you out. And we found the email going through old emails. And we called him and this guy, Jay, and he had worked at ESPN for years and he freelances and he's a huge fan of mine. And he was at my house for like 2 weeks when I had this set up in my base, in my downstairs in Westchester. And this guy was, then we moved down here. He came down here and set it up.
Awesome.
And I actually moved once since I've been down here. I was at a huge studio. And we weren't using all the space. I was paying too much money. And then I found this thing 9 minutes from my house. And, everything. I've been very fortunate since I got to Georgia. And I'm not a tech guy either. So I'm glad I had people. And Tommy Nicky, my manager, has done more for me in 2 years than all my managers and agents combined. This guy is a force to be reckoned with. So it sort of came together like a perfect storm.
Did you not want to do it from your house? Do you want to rent a studio or do you didn't want to do it from your new place?
I didn't. I wanted to do it from a studio because, the acoustics are better. And, I wasn't crazy about working and living in the same space. You know what I mean? So yeah, this is so convenient. It's ridiculous. I make it here in literally 9 minutes and I look forward to it. And then I'm home by 3:30 in the afternoon. And
there's something about
you're just kind of looking around going, there's got to be a catch. Like there's got to be a catch somewhere. This is too easy. Doubt. Everything's working too well.
Oh yeah, they'll find a melanoma on my back or something in the next couple of days.
That's better than what they find on mine.
What, dry? Some flaky stuff? A nice dry flaky? I don't know why I look like I'm in the dark here. I have my lights on.
It's probably because the background is... is that a green screen behind you or is that your actual...
No, that's an actual backdrop.
Sometimes and Zoom
I've,
does it.
I've done found, a ton of these. I've... Jason, do we know why I look dark? Anything we're doing?
Because what you're usually seeing is color corrected in our program.
This is
going through Zoom, so it's not working.
Yeah, but we always use Zoom, and I don't look this dark. Right? Yeah. Okay. Color correction, whatever. I don't know.
Okay.
Jimmy has a rainbow.
Yeah, I like it. It makes me happy.
All the colors of the rainbow.
You look like Michael Stipe doing a benefit.
Well, I normally don't use this backdrop. That's normally the one that I use.
Tony Montana.
Yeah, that's Frank's office.
That's Frank's office. Fuck their fucking death, brothers.
So you're going to be give Nick the proper plug. We have to end our show shortly.
Yes.
Absolutely. Nick DiPaolo, you guys can see him perform this coming Saturday, 2 days. He'll be in Las Vegas at the Plaza Hotel and Casino, but you can watch him from the comfort of your own home at thecomicsgym.com. It's 10 p.m. Eastern this Saturday. See Nick DiPaolo live from Las Vegas.
Yeah, and watchlivenow.com. I'm not sure why we're not giving that out. Watchlivenow.com. And, yeah, we'll be streaming it Saturday night. I think, 10 Eastern.
Okay. Right? And your show. Yeah.
And my show.
Yeah. I was going to say the Nick DiPaolo show.
You get tickets
Monday through
at Nick
Thursday, 5 p.m.
Yeah, Monday through Thursday, 5 p.m. Eastern. You can watch my show. And, fellas, I appreciate you letting me do this. I like the beard,
Sam. Sure.
Looks good, man.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, but great. I'm trying to keep it like controlled enough that people don't think it's just a quarantine thing. It's just it's not a depression beard. It's a fine line.
Yes, it looks good.
Thank you,
all right,
man.
Buddy. Yeah, nickdip.com for the show and for tickets and for whatever you need. But you're doing good down there, man. I'm happy for you.
Thank you, Jimmy. I appreciate it, man.
Okay, pal.
Talk to
Be
you.
Good.
All right. Talk to you soon.
Yeah, Nick I tell DiPaolo. You, man, the idea of paying less money than I'm paying here is
for
appealing.
A lot more.
Yeah, man, there is something about that. And with Anthony going, it's like I know him so well, and I know he's so. I'm not moving to a southern state. I kind of get the appeal of it. Less money.
Even if you moved outside this, even if you moved to like. A Jersey suburb or something like that. I mean, you know, it's a little, you're still paying big property taxes around here. Like, you know, I'm outside of the city and it's amazing, but I'm not, you know, my cost of living anywhere else would be so much less. I mean, I like it here. I'm not leaving. Sorry, Troy. But,
your buddies are down here, man.
That's true. I forgot what it was. Jess texted Troy something. It was like something, I don't even remember what it was. It was a few days ago. And she said, I texted Troy and asked him, and he just keeps texting me back about how all your wrestling buddies are down in Florida and we should go down there.
I don't know, man.
Stop.
I'm happier down here than I've been in a very long time. I'll tell you that.
Are you going to stay there after this is all done?
You know, it depends. I mean, it really depends on work, really. I mean, if Sirius is like, you don't have to come back, then hell yeah, this is where I'm at. You know, but if they're like... Yeah. You're going to lose your job unless you come back here. Then sure. I have to go back, but I don't
I'm gonna
want
be honest,
to.
I think my vibe is that Troy is really banking on me putting my foot down and staying home, and that way he can say, "Well, if Sam's going to stay home, you know, I can come up with a similar setup." I really think he's hoping that I set a precedent so that he can stay in Florida.
Yeah, I mean, dude, it's sunny. I mean, the sun's coming out. I'm going to go for a jog. It's like 75 degrees. I have a studio. You know what I mean? I have was able to set up all my instruments, my amp. Like I didn't have that space in New York.
Right.
So now I can actually have a nice setup and get creative and do creative things.
I'm mixed. Like I kind of like being home. I like the idea of not having to go anywhere. And then I miss going to work. Like I get why Nick drives to a studio 9 minutes away. There's something about going someplace and working that I do kind of like. I feel I'm cooped up. You know, you get fucking claustrophobic. After a while, I'm ready to leave the house and go to work.
I do like leaving the house, you know, but not because I have to. Like I'll go out and like run an errand or something. Or I like going to the gym, for instance. That's twice a week, right? And I'm just going because I'm going to the gym or going to get food or, you know, going out for a drive or whatever. But yeah, I don't like the idea of leaving for an extended period of time on somebody else's clock.
Well, our commutes are also very different, too. Like, you have to drive in, you have to park in a lot. Like, for me, the only pain in the ass I have is the Uber will be a few minutes. But, I mean, it's like 8, 9, 10 minutes to work maximum for me. So it's a little bit easier for me just to hop in an Uber and go than it is to drive in from fucking Westchester, park in the lot, walk over. You know, it's the whole thing.
Can I tell you some backstory on this Undertaker sexy and secret? Kane interview?
Oh.
It's a sexy secret that's going to air today that you're going to, all of you guys are going to love what happened to me. I was taken advantage of in a very vulnerable state.
What do you mean?
Like, okay, so clearly, so Not Sam Wrestling is my show on the WWE Network. It's on the free version, so you guys can watch it. You just go and hit it up. And this morning, the episode will come out. I think it'll come out at 10 a.m. Eastern. It's my interview with The Undertaker and Kane together, which is like a huge deal. I mean, it's a huge deal in general, but obviously like a crazy huge deal for me, especially because it's the whole hour, right? So this is something that I'm really thinking about and really planning. And I also know that, you know, guys like The Undertaker and Kane, like their time is valuable, and it's not easy to get interviews, especially long form interviews. Like even when Undertaker did our show, I was working on that for like weeks. And you know, I put pressure on myself because it's like this has to be good. Like how many opportunities am I going to get like this
with both of them?
So I'm feeling like a ton of pressure and everything and excitement and nerves and this whole thing. And as the days were leading up to when I actually did the interview, I was like feeling it a little more every day. I knew it was coming and like, okay, like just trying to make sure everything was going to work out, you know, testing the technology I had to get because we did it over Zoom. So I had to get Hot Dog and Reed, you remember Reed, on the Zoom call so that they could each record a screen and we could have all the video and making sure that everything was going to work out right. Because I'm doing this, like I said, I'm totally doing this myself, right?
So wait, each one of those guys pinned either The Undertaker or Kane and recorded them separately. Yeah.
Yeah, so I assigned Kane to Reed, I assigned Undertaker to Hot Dog, and then I recorded myself here.
Would you have been upset if there was a miscommunication and they both only recorded Kane?
There were multiple, there was repetition in the instruction and repeat back to me. Like there wasn't anything left to free thought. There was, yeah, no, yeah, yes, because it would have been very, very upsetting.
Oh, I thought so the way I did it,
yeah.
we did a safety where I record everything on my camera, which is not plugged into Zoom. And then I actually recorded like a Zoom window with all the monitors in it. So we still would have had footage of everything. It's just the resolution wouldn't have been very good. But we got everything that we needed. Everything worked out great. But the day before the interview, I'm thinking about this. And a WWE employee who I will not name because it's a goof and he's a buddy. But I don't want to name him because I don't want to get him in trouble. He texts me. And he's like, bro, just so you know, Undertaker's pissed. He's got a lot of press, and it may not go smoothly tomorrow. I was like, all right, no problem. Like, it's okay. Like, I'll do a lot of work. I'm going to make sure the questions are interesting. I'm going to make sure it stands out. Like, okay, I can deal with that, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, and he's like, okay, just letting you know. It's weird and a lot of topics and stuff. I'm like, you know what? Just tell me if there's anything that he specifically isn't reacting to well. And the person goes, okay, I'll let you know. And throughout the day, I'm getting a text like, don't bring up anything with this. It's like, oh, okay, no problem. Okay. don't bring up anything with that. And I'm literally writing stuff down. I'm watching YouTube videos. I'm researching matches that I hadn't researched so I can reform my questions and stuff. And I'm doing all this stuff and going through everything. And this was going on over the course of hours. And then finally it was like, all right, dude, just so you know, his schedule might be cleared totally tomorrow. We don't know for sure. It might not happen. I was like, I trust you guys implicitly. Like, whatever you have to do, it's cool. Like, the best case scenario will turn out. And he's like, okay. And you can't talk about this either. I was like, okay, no problem. And then they go, there is the one thing he said that never gets brought up is there was a match that Undertaker and Kane had with the Headbangers in Medicine Hat, Alberta, Canada. And they ended up going 75 minutes because half the roster couldn't get to the show. And he said, nobody ever brings up that match. I was like, oh, shit, that's great. Thank you. And I wrote it down so I could have it on the thing. And, like, I'm talking to Jess about it. I'm like, oh, so, like, I'm a little nervous because, you know, I'm getting all this information and blah, blah, blah. Hours are going by. I'm like, okay. I'm like, hopefully. It's now, like, 6 o'clock at night. And this employee goes, like, okay, it looks like we might be on. I was like, okay, great. And he's like, also, I need to tell you that everything I've told you today is a lie. I was like, what? Everything, the whole from beginning to end, these are all made up stories, a total fabrication. Like, I just made it up for my own amusement. I was like, you son of a bitch. I was like, look, I usually try to save face in scenarios like this, but you really got me. Like,
re-stressing really. Out?
I was stressing out.
Did you tell them?
Questions.
Did you tell them that he had fucked with you and like he told me I can't ask this, I can't ask that.
So then, the next day is when I recorded the interview, and like the Undertaker signs on, and before we started the interview, he's like, "So, you gonna ask me about the big match in Medicine Hat?" I was like, "You guys got me really." He knew about the whole thing.
Did that match actually happen?
No.
Oh, okay. Well, I mean, then that's even more impressive because they got one over on you of a match that you've never heard of.
And I'm sitting there Googling. I'm like, why haven't I heard of this match? Like, it didn't occur to me. It's because they're tricking you, stupid. Like,
he shouldn't have told you that one. He should have let you ask the Medicine Hat question. That was a mistake. So, he should have told you that one was the truth.
And that's what I told him, too. I was like, bro, you should have let me go because I would have asked this question. And he said, yeah, the only thing is this employee's fear was if Taker had forgotten about the goof because there's just stuff going on in the day. And then I asked him and then he was confused and then I was confused and then it somehow got back to him. He didn't want to like create a situation where there was actual trouble. But he said otherwise he absolutely would have left me out in the wind. Just
do they try to keep the Undertaker happy there? Like, are they, is he a higher up guy there?
He's the guy. Yeah. Yeah. But he's also, like, you'll see it. If you watch the interview, and you probably caught the vibe when we talked to him, but, like, you'll see it when you watch the interview. Like, he's just such a cool dude. Like, that you can tell why he's so respected, because he's just engaging and fun to talk to and a good storyteller and loves this stuff.
How long did you have him for?
An hour.
Wow. This is funny, too, because you were such a fan of his. And, like, I would love to interview him. And I saw him on an elevator once, and I didn't talk to him. And it's like, then you have him here, and then you have him again. It's like, now he knows you.
Yeah. Yeah, it's wild. Especially after, like, the whole, like, and that's why, you know, this prank that they pulled on me was ultimately a good thing. Because the fact that Undertaker the next day brought it up. Like, if I brought up Medicine Hat to him next time I saw him, he would know exactly what I was talking about.
He would remember it.
He loves pranks, Undertaker. He loves when people get pranked. So he was happy that I had really gotten, that they'd really gotten one over.
They got you. Would you go to his house?
I mean, if the invitation was on the table, I probably wouldn't show up unannounced.
No, but if he said, like, look, we're doing this thing where... as a profile, and you could walk through the house, and I'll show you around, like, my yard and the house and my basement and all my memorabilia.
Yeah. Yeah, I'd probably check that out. Yeah, I'd probably take advantage of that opportunity, yeah.
Would you be nervous?
No, I'd be excited. I don't know if I'd be nervous.
Would you bring your chair from the sign?
No, that would probably be in poor taste. Yeah. I would probably sometimes you gotta accept your victories for what they are.
Sure.
You know, like you can't be in that space where you just need a little more. You just need a little more.
Yeah, but you're missing that signature.
No, I don't have the signature, but you know, I at this point I have enough.
Yeah, do you though?
Yeah.
You don't have the signature.
You'd love to have that signature.
Yeah, when this is all over. That
would be nice.
Yeah.
The
signature would be a nice additional item. Yeah, it would be a nice perk.
Let me ask you, was this an idea that you pitched to the network, or did they like?
No, I pitched them on it. Yeah,
that's awesome.
Because I heard they put out a documentary that's really good. They just put it out on the network on Sunday, but they premiered it at the Austin Film Festival called The Brothers of Destruction, and it's the name that Undertaker and Kane used together, and it's basically Undertaker and Kane just kind of sitting down and telling stories together, just talking to each other about the whole journey they went on.
Were they a team at one point?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. They were rivals and then a team.
I'll just watch that then.
You can watch both. I watched, and then I watched the doc because I was really worried that it was going to be super repetitive, but I was happy that it was not.
Yeah.
So they complement, the interview complements the doc very well. But yeah, so when I found out that doc was going to be made or coming out on the network or whatever, I reached out kind of immediately and was like, hey,
that's great.
This would be an awesome opportunity to do something.
Would and you have been embarrassed when he came crazy. In? With when he came in, would you have been embarrassed if I went under?
Nothing worse than the wrong abbreviation. I mean,
why would anyone say that?
Would you pick the wrong... wrong nicknames will give me douche chills. Like, why? Yeah. There's nothing human about. Why would you think?
So under when you get in the under when you were in that one, I mean, was the adrenaline pumping?
Like Taker just without even knowing that's his nickname. Any person with any sense would just assume.
Yeah.
If you're going to do it, you just go, oh, what's up, Taker? But to say, what's up, under?
Under.
Yeah. Or UT.
It's such a,
UT.
It's just, it's such a forced closeness, like a forced fake closeness. So gross.
Yeah, he would.
But yeah, so the interview will be up in a few minutes over on the free version of the WWE Network, so.
Yeah, congratulations on getting those guys together. I'm happy for you. I know you love him so much. So that's a big one.
Yeah, it's wild that they were able to get him together and that they hooked me up like that. WWE they certainly did right by me there.
Yeah. Well, that's the advantage of being on the network, too. They want the show. And he probably told me it's for our, you know. So did you ask for his number?
No, I didn't ask for his number.
So listen, Taker, I might have a few follow-up questions. You know,
should I text him? Should I
give you a text?
Yeah, should I hit you up on the text? What is your number, by the way? Yeah, I didn't. I don't think I got your number. Do you have mine?
Yeah.
Like no.
You should go to the network now and be like, "Hey, that was great. What about Stone Cold and The Rock?"
Yeah, Stone Cold and The Rock. Also, I heard Bill Simmons was producing something about Vince McMahon. Like, should we get him on?
How about the whole McMahon family? This one went so well.
Everybody together? Yeah, I don't see why not. It could be a round
table. Pitch an awful idea. Family feud with the McMahons.
Well, who would they compete against? My family, the Roberts.
Yeah,
it's the Roberts versus the McMahons. Yeah.
Wrestling knowledge.
Yeah. Wrestling trivia family feud. The McMahons versus the Roberts.
Would you interview Vince if he wanted to be on the show?
Yeah. Yeah. That would be a fun interview.
Why don't you pitch for it? You can probably pitch for it, right?
Yeah, why not? You want the show to be good.
I'll figure out a time to mention it.
That would be such a hard thing to do.
Yeah, why? I mean, because
he might want to do it for his network.
But you'd have to figure out what you're... I mean, there's so much to talk to him about.
And you don't know what might upset him or...
Right. Like, you have to figure out your... you have to figure out your trap doors, like your questions, right. And here's the trap door if he gets pissed to get out of.
Any emotion, really. Like when they were talking about the Undertaker in the last ride, and he's like mm-hmm. on the verge of tears, and he's like, just tells them, like, we have to stop.
Wait, Vince said we have to stop?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Why was he going to cry?
Because they're so close, and they asked him, like, what does the Undertaker mean to this company and to you personally? And, like, you could see he started to well up, and then he just kind of did the throat-cutting gesture and went, like, nope, can't do that.
Yeah. It was a great
match. And they kept it in?
Yeah, but they left it in, which obviously he was like, yeah, you know, he would give a sign-off on everything. So the fact that they left it in I thought was amazing.
I think Jim would like that series.
The Last Ride?
Yeah.
Yeah, The Last Ride's really, really good.
I'd make him cry.
Okay. You make who cry?
Vince. Everyone.
How would you do that?
I would ask a strong question.
Like, what kind of poignant question?
Picture the Taker is asking for help and you can't get to him.
Under.
And then you take a drink as if you knew. I got you, didn't I?
Yeah.
You can't get to him.
The tears are going to cry.
Yeah, I guess that would be really sad, Jim. Yeah, I guess.
I remember some awful acting exercise I did once. We were in acting class, and you had to close your eyes and yell at somebody who was hurting someone that you loved. Oof. Mm. It was awful.
Maybe you could get him to do that.
It's melodramatic. What's that?
Maybe you could get him to do that.
Yeah. I didn't do the exercise right because I was usually the one hurting them. So I had to yell, yay, and this is fun.
Oh. All right, guys. Well, look.
We're gone for a while.
We're gone for a week, yeah. Yep. So, you know, I don't mind, you know, don't inundate with complaints. Some complaints would be nice.
Sure.
Just to feel.
So you notice.
Just an. Enough to feel loved, yeah.
Yeah.
You know, not so many that I feel bad, but just like
right.
enough that you know people care. If you guys wouldn't mind, like maybe throw a complaint, maybe pick 2 days next week and do one complaint one day, one complaint the next. And if that way, if you all kind of spread out your complaints, it might be just enough.
A little complaint. But by the way, complain to the company when we're not there because it makes us look good. If no one complains to the company.
Yeah.
And if you want merchandise, a Christmas gift, go to chipchipperson.com. The Christmas Chipmas section is open, and there's shirts, and there's mugs. There's the Paulus mug and the Paulus shirt that's been a big hit. And, people like the Paulus merchandise. And Santa Paul is another shirt. I haven't had a whole lot of Uncle Paul merchandise. I have a couple of things now, which people enjoy. And thank you to Colin and Bobby, of course. Watch that special Colin Quinn and Friends. I don't even know what it's called. The parking lot show on HBO
Parking
Max.
Lot comedy show, yep.
Yeah, it was heartbreaking that I couldn't be there for that. That really bothers me that I was not there.
And if there are complaints that you want the company to hear, I talked to Jim McClure yesterday, and he said he was going to start doing a Travis Teft DM audit.
Oh, good.
So if you want to just throw your complaints in Travis Teft on Twitter in his DMs.
I mean, they're going to do it anyway.
Yeah.
Those will all be read by SiriusXM. So go ahead and be active.
They have access to my account? Active.
Yeah.
Shit.
They do. They're doing it's a DM
contract.
On you specifically. Yeah. It's part, part of our contract. It's our request.
If you want to see Nick DiPaolo stuff, go to nickdip.com. If you want to see his live special or you know, support him and watch his show. You know, thanks to Nick too for being on today.
And get on that free version of the WWE Network, okay?
Yes.
All right, guys. See you later.
Bye. Happy Thanksgiving.
Yeah, happy Thanksgiving.
We'll be back with more Jim Norton and Sam Roberts.